To all on the behalf of CSIR CRRI, I welcome all the participants, panelists, and the attendees for this three-day international webinar on health monitoring, service life prediction, repair and rehabilitation of structures. First of all, I would like to thank Director CSIR CRRI for taking out time from his busy schedule to inaugurate this international webinar. We have world-renowned panelists for this webinar, including Sri BVL Patankar, who is the former DG of MORT, Ministry of Road Transport and Highway, Sri Shishir Bansal, who is the Superintending Engineer, Orissa PWD, and Shishir Bansal, Chief Project Manager, DTTC, New Delhi. Sri R.C. Vaishnay, who is the professor and the head of Civil Department and MNNIIT Allahabad. Then we have esteemed speakers with us, Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran. She is the Chief Scientist, Bridge Engineering and Structures Division, CSIR CRRI. Dr. BVL Kantha Rao, who is also Senior Principal Scientist in the Bridge Division of CSIR CRRI. Then we have Sri G.K. Sahu, who is the Organizing Committee Secretary. Then we have Sri S.S. Geherwar, who is the Senior Principal Scientist of Bridge Engineering and Structures Division, CSIR CRRI. Then we have Dr. Rajiv Goyal, Senior Principal Scientist, CSIR CRRI. And we have Sri SSK Sharma, who is the retired Principal Technical Officer from CSIR CRRI. I welcome you all again on the behalf of CSIR CRRI. So first I would request Director CRRI to inaugurate this webinar with his welcome address.
Thank you. Thank you, Naveen. I extend my very warm welcome to all the participants, presenters, and panelists to this 3 days web seminar on health monitoring, service life prediction, repair, and rehabilitation of structures. Now, this is the third webinar organized by CRRI during this lockdown period. The earlier two were on payments. One was on recycling, and another was on use of steel slag in road construction. And like these two seminars, the third seminar is also quite hit. As I understand, there are more than 700 participants from different parts of the country. Now, this webinar assumes significance because construction sector is extremely important, and the government of India is also pushing a lot of resources to build new projects. And you might be knowing that this sector contributes almost 7% of India's GDP. And it includes power, dams, roads, railways, and urban infrastructure development. In 2018, India was ranked at 44th position out of 167 countries in the world by World Bank Logistic Performance Index. The major part of the funds in infrastructure goes to railways and roadways. And major structures in these two segments are the bridges. We are building new highways and bridges as part of any road development project. In addition to these new projects, is there any? I was telling that we are building new highways and bridges as part of any road development project. In addition to these new projects, our engineers are also required to keep the old bridges also in serviceable condition. And there are many bridges on Indian Railways which are 100 or more than 100 years old. Is there some misconnection? Harshvardhan is being connected.
We can hear you, sir. We can hear you, sir.
No, no, you can hear me, but there seems to be some misconnection. I see Dr. Harshvardhan. Sometime on the screen.
I'm able to hear, sir. You carry on. I will keep the video off.
Okay.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can. In 2018, in a written reply to the parliament, it was told by the Minister of State for Railways that almost 37,000 railway bridges are 100 years old and six.
Can you hear me, sir?
Sorry? And 6,680 are more than 140 years old. Now, railway bridges across the railway
bridge. Are you able to hear me?
Please mute your speaker.
Are you able to hear me? I'm not.
Now you hear me now. You please mute yourself. The railway bridge across the river Mahi in Madhya Pradesh near Ratlam was built in 1890. And this number, when I say 37,000 railway bridges are 100 years or more than 100 years old, it makes almost 26% of all bridges on Indian Railways. The situation is extremely poor. Peculiar. And the current plan of the railways is to replace almost 600 bridges per year. And if you go by this speed, it will take almost 60 years to replace all the 37,000 bridges, which are 100 years or more than 100 years old. And you can appreciate that at the end of this, the bridge which is being constructed today will become 60 years old. Now, that situation is almost similar on highways also. Now, the challenge before the engineers is to keep these structures in working conditions, and therefore their health monitoring and repair and maintenance are the regular activities now. Now, scientists of CSIR, CRRI have carried out several projects of health assessment, repair and rehabilitation, and instrumentation of bridges in various parts of the country. They have very rich experience of working in the field as well as in the laboratory. Now, this webinar is designed to cover all aspects of field testing of old structures, quality control and quality assurance in the new projects, and health monitoring through instrumentation of structures. It will also cover the theory part of failure mechanism and service life protection models for concrete. I'm sure you will find this web seminar extremely useful, and many of your doubts and questions on this extremely important subject will be cleared during these 3 days. The seminar is organized in such a manner that there is a panel of experts who will be responding to the questions raised by the participants after each lecture. The participants can type their queries in the chat box, and I would request all the panelists to keep a watch on the chat box and reply to these queries even during the lecture also while texting through the chat box only. And after the lecture is over, then all remaining queries can be answered by the speaker. With these remarks, I again welcome you all and wish a very great success to this 3 days webinar on extremely important topic of health monitoring and repair of structures. Thank you very much. Thanks, Rajiv.
Dr. Navi.
Thank you, Director, sir. Some of the panelists have just now joined us. So let me just introduce you. Dr. Harshvardhan Subbarao, he is the MD Constructma Consultants. Professor Tarun Kant, he joined us. Maybe I think he left us again. Maybe he'll join later. So he is the Adjunct Professor of IIT Mumbai. Dr. Narayan Pal, he is the Superintending Engineer, Orissa PWD. And Mr. Shishir Bansal, he is the Chief Engineer, CPWD, Leh Ladakh. So I'll just brief some of the technical points which will help us during this webinar. So currently we have total 425 participants, and we will first start with the presentation, and I request you to type your questions in the chat box, and also you can type in the question and answer tab, which you can see at the bottom of your screen. And we will like to take the questions of the panelists in the end to supplement their views, and then we'll take the pending questions as directed by the director CRI in the end of the presentation. So I think we can start with the first presentation, first speaker, Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran. I request you to share your screen and start the presentation, please.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Continue.
Okay. A very good morning to all of you. Thank you, Director Professor Satish Chandra, for your welcome address and telling the participants about the relevance of this 3-day webinar on health monitoring, service life prediction, repair and rehabilitation of structures. And my presentation has been structured in 4 parts. First, I'll be speaking about the infrastructure rating, then structural health monitoring, the basic concepts, components, and the recent developments, service life prediction models, the basic concepts, and some of the commercially available products. Then the repair and rehabilitation, which is very challenging for engineers to implement in the field to extend the life of the structures. And as we all know that infrastructure is the backbone to the nation's economy, and it is very critical for nation's prosperity, public health, and welfare. The infrastructure system, it includes buildings, transport infrastructure, whether it is road transport, railway, or airport, or like even the shipping transport, including the port infrastructure, dams, then the water lines, gas lines, sewer lines, power transmission, and we cannot forget the telecom network. Just because of the revolution of the telecom network during the last 2 decades, we are able today to hold this webinar in this mode when other systems are in a lockdown condition. So they are very critical for nation's prosperity, and it has a cascading effect in our nation's economy because it impacts the business productivity and GDP, as told by Professor Satish Chandra, generates employment, personal income, and also it improves the international competitiveness. So now the big challenge for us is how do we assess the performance of infrastructure network? And we just heard Professor Satish Chandra telling about that some 37,000 railway bridges, they are not in good condition. But I would like to start with a success story of Pamban Bridge. And this bridge, as you know, it's built during 1911 to 1914, a railway bridge. First, it was carrying only a single track, and it is more than 2 kilometers long, and it has 144 spans. It was only originally designed for a meter gauge and then subsequently upgraded to broad gauge. That means it has undergone a capacity augmentation. And what are the challenges there in that environment? This bridge is located at cyclone-prone region and in a marine environment. And it was damaged during the Rameshwaram cyclone in 1964, and along with the cyclone, you know that there will be some storm surges, and it was subjected to a storm surge of almost 7.6 meter. And of course, like there is a comparison between a bridge and a human being, like almost both these, they have similar life. So this bridge, and we also fell sick. So similarly, the bridge also got damaged during 2013 because of barge impact, and some cracks appeared in the bridge during 2013. But I think we generally get notice of the engineer's attention, like when they built a new structure. But I think probably this time has come to recognize the engineers who are maintaining these structures for such a long time. So there should be some provision for that. Then the maintenance engineers, they will also contribute more significantly to their work. And another important aspect of this bridge is that this is the first sea bridge which provided a double leaf vesicle section. So that means the middle section can be raised for the passage of the bridge. So these are the challenges which some of, most of these challenges we take into account during the design stage, but there are certain uncertainties during the life of the structure which the we have to manage during their lifetime. Now, let us see how it is done internationally. Here, I want to say that there is an infrastructure report card provided for every structure. And what I am showing in the screen, this is the infrastructure card criteria provided by American Society of Civil Engineers, where they do grade the infrastructure based on A, B, C, D, E category, based on these parameters. That is, first is the capacity, whether the infrastructure's capacity meet the current and future demands. What is the present condition of the structure, or in the near future, what will be its condition? Then the main important aspect is the fund required for maintaining the structure, whether we have sufficient budget now or whether it will be met during the future time. Then what is the operation and maintenance requirement, whether the owner is able to provide the infrastructure properly, or whether the infrastructure is compliant with the government regulation. And public safety is very, very important aspect, because whether to what extent the public safety is jeopardized by the condition of the structure, and if a failure happens, what will happen? So all these parameters are very, very important. And another important aspect is whether the infrastructure has the ability to prevent or protect against multi-hazard threat or incidents. For example, there may be some seismic action, or there may be some cyclone, or maybe some seismic with tsunami, or there may be some man-made disaster. So whether it can come back to its original condition in a short time. So these are very, very important aspects. Then now they have added another important aspect, that is the innovation. That is, what new innovative techniques, material technologies, or the delivery methods. That is, how quickly we can incorporate these things to the structure so that we can improve the infrastructure. So these are the parameters now based on which the US infrastructure system, that is 16 a number of them, they are being rated. But this rating is not done every year, but it is done 4 years, once in 4 years, and basically it is done by a committee, and it has 28 civil engineers across the country with decades of experience in various categories, and they basically volunteer their time to work to prepare the US infrastructure grade scale. But it is not limited to US alone. We have some stories from UK, where institution of civil engineers, they do this particular job. But it has now moved to other developing countries. We will be surprised that the World Engineering Forum, they have done it for Africa, and many of the African countries like Ghana, they have started doing the infrastructure report card for their structures. But they have started with a small number, four numbers to begin with for this. So probably, I think this is one way how we have to move ahead. And this will definitely help us the planning requirements, and also it will give more confidence to the users of this infrastructure. And more importantly, we will be prepared for some calamities which are likely to happen. For example, like if we have something for our health system, probably we may not have to be in the lockdown condition for a long time during this pandemic period. Now, how this is done? Basically, the infrastructure rating tool, this is based on some multiple attribute decision making system. And the one what I am sharing is published in AAC journal. And also this is the work of Georgia Institute of Technology. And you can see the parameters which I discuss, that is the condition, capacity, operation and maintenance, funding, future need, public safety and resilience. They are given scores, that is in a 10 point scale. So you can see inadequate, poor, mediocre, good or exceptionals for every structure. Then you can normalize the scores. Then there is an important point here that weights are assigned to each of these criteria. But you cannot simply assign a weight. You have to give a justification why you are choosing 0.1 or 0.2 or 0.15. Then the weights are totaled and we get a ranking for this particular infrastructure system. So, and this is not only done in a national level, but it is being done state level as well as it is being done region wise as well. So this is how, this is the trend, how the infrastructure is rated globally. Now, the another important aspect from this infrastructure rating is that we need to assess the condition of the structure. So the question arises, how do we do it? So, and what we have to do it? We have to basically detect the damages which are there, and then the diagnosis part, that is where it is, the damage is there, what type of damage is there, and what is the severity of damage. And then we may be interested in, suppose I am not able to do an intervention now, what is the remaining life of for this particular structure? Why I am talking about is, India is a developing country and we are now focusing on developing our road network, and we have limited resources. So there is a fund crunch, so our entire focus is on developing the new network, but we have to also now start focusing how we can preserve our already constructed road network, so that like it delivered more to our countries, it leads to more to our country's economy. Now, how it is done is that the visual inspection, along with that, non-destructive testing and evaluation method. And about this, you will hear more from Mr. Gherwar in his tomorrow's lecture. And one thing we have to understand about the visual inspection-based condition rating, I'll be giving a lecture on condition rating tomorrow. Basically, the condition rating based on visual inspection, that depends on the human judgment, and the rating may not exhibit high degree of consistency when performed by different inspectors. Here I want to flag an issue that India, though we have so many bridges, but we don't have trained bridge inspectors, which is an issue which we have to address immediately. And you can imagine how many bridge inspectors are required, because we have added so many structures in our system. Then visual inspection based rating is restricted to easily accessible component. But how can we identify the hidden flaws and anomalies in the components which are not accessible quickly? Probably that is one of the reason why people hesitate in going to bridge and inspect a bridge. But if you see many of the old bridges like Lohapul in Delhi or like Thane Creek Bridge in Mumbai, there is a walkway provided so that like a person can walk and go to various component and see the defect. So the accessibility for bridge inspection is another important aspect. Probably we have to think something about it during the planning stage itself. Then bridge inspections and supplementary NDE are time-consuming and expensive. I'm sure that there may be a debate why like it is expensive, but you have to think during the 100-year service life, like how many times one has to go and see that, do the inspection, and a team is required to do so along with NDE assessment. So that's why like it may appear to be expensive during the lifetime of the structure. Now, where do we draw the motivation for highway bridge structural health monitoring? As I told, the structural failures, don't think that it is only limited to our country, but there are cases from a global scenario where you will see that the first photograph, that is of Silver Bridge, and in USA, and it collapsed like during 1967, and 46 people, they died, and that led to enact mandatory bridge inspection by US Congress. So you can see that from 1967 in US, the bridge inspection started. Then there are cases of other bridges like I-35 bridge collapse in 2007, where 13 people dead. Then Songsu Bridge in South Korea in 1994, where 31 people dead. There are many such cases available. So that means like there may be some, these are very critical infrastructure, and failure not only can lead to the disruption of transport network, but also like it can cause damage, it can take the human life as well. And in India also, the collapse of old Mandavi Bridge in 1986, this was an eye-opener for consideration of durability aspects in bridge design. I think some of you must be knowing that it was introduced as a special publication, SP-33, and subsequently the clauses which were there in SP-33, they were brought back to various IRC codes, which are being used for bridge design. And now definitely we have given some emphasis for durability aspect in our bridge code, IRC 112, where we have specifying four exposure condition, because essentially the failure of Mandavi occurred because corrosion of the pre-stressed cable. Probably the material what they used and the water what they used for curing, they were having some contamination of salt. So that led to the this failure of the Mandavi. And also that led to the motivation to the instrumentation of highway bridges in India. I remember I want to really appreciate the vision of then MoRTH DG, Mr. K.K. Sareen, who in late 1988 approached SERC Ghaziabad, and there we started this bridge instrumentation activity, and where my colleagues, Mr. Sahu, Mr. Goyal, and all, Mr. Gehrwar, they were all very young engineers, and they took up this as a challenge. And you will see that from tomorrow's presentation, how many bridges were instrumented by the then SERC, that is like the Ganga Bridge to start with, and then Mandavi Bridge, New Mandavi Bridge, and then Tane Creek Bridge and Airoli Bridge. So you will be able to listen to Mr. Sahu tomorrow in his interesting lecture. Now, there are many students also present here. So for their benefit, I would like to say what exactly is the structural health monitoring. Basically, it is a non-destructive in-situ structural sensing and evaluation method that uses a variety of sensors attached to or embedded in a structure to monitor the structural response, to analyze the structural characteristic for the purpose of estimating the severity of damage, deterioration, and evaluating the consequence thereof on the structure in terms of response, capacity, and service life. And it essentially may include like some of the NDT or NDE evaluation techniques, but the NDT or NDE, I would compare them with like we go to some clinic, get our blood test done or x-ray taken, like that. Maybe one-time assessment for condition assessment of material at a single point. But SHM, it may be a continuous activity or it may be a repeated assessment of the structure. And why we go for SHM is that it provides structural monitoring during construction stage and validate the design assumptions by measuring the actual structural response. It improves the design specification for future structures. Some of the data what we collected from the SHM of the earlier bridges, they have gone into IRC6. For example, the temperature clause that has taken from here. Then it reduced the frequency and the cost of the bridge inspection. It provides the owners with real-time tool to support the decision-making process for optimal maintenance planning. And it helps to assess the integrity of structure with respect to extreme events like cyclones and earthquake, etc. Also, it helps in the efficacy, evaluate the efficacy of strengthening measures. Now, when we look into the components, it starts with sensors, data acquisition network, communication data, data processing, storage of the data, what we processed, and then use them for diagnostic and prognostic purpose. But here, one has to understand that there is no sensor available to measure the damage which may happen to the bridge. And the damage may be in terms of some pier settlement or abnormal movement of the bearing or expansion joint or substructure movement or the cracking or rupture of tendon or maybe some effect due to the shrinkage and creep, et cetera. And also you will see that it is not alone a civil engineering field now. It has components of electrical, electronics, and communication. So that means like we have to change our mindset rather than working in a very close compartment, but to coordinate with the other engineering aspects so that we are able to do the structural health monitoring very effectively. I am not going in detail of these sensing technologies, but to start with, basically, like you are not able to measure the damage, but what we do is like you measure the performance parameters, and like for the design, you use stress as a parameter. That is, you do the stress check always, but we are not able to measure even the stress, but the strain can be measured and it is converted into stress. So like you have the electrical strain gauge, vibrating wire gauge, and now fiber optics sensors are available. Then there is displacement measuring system like LVDT or automatic target recognition system. And here you will see that maybe there is lot of change in the electronics and like communication technology. So maybe like earlier the sensors were large in size, but now very miniature sensors are available, which can be used for the sensing purpose. But there are certain advanced technologies now available, like digital image correlation method. This is essentially an optical method for deformation mapping. Basically, it employs tracking of the image registration technique for accurate 2D and 3D measurement. Basically, it uses from the change in images is used to indicate or measure the displacement and strain. Similarly, the other method is the interferometry method. Again, here, either the displacement is measured from the videos or mode shapes. So these are some of the upcoming technologies for the structural health monitoring. And you can visualize the structural health monitoring. You can see here that is essentially start with the sensors. Now the question comes, where to keep the sensors, how to select the sensors, what type of data acquisition system I should have, and how do I communicate the data. Earlier days, like we used to collect it on site itself, but now it is possible to do it in a remote manner, and then the data processing, then do the diagnostic. So this gives a visual picture. So the question is, how do we select the sensors and where the sensors are to be kept? Because everything ultimately boils down to the cost of the system. So what we have to do is to optimize the sensor requirement and also the data collected, because too much data also, it will become difficult to interpret them. Then determine the critical sensor location. How do we do it? We have to have a mathematical model of the structure. We should have a feel about the behavior of the structure, identify the critical locations, and then provide the sensors. And we have to think about what is the sensitivity of that particular sensor, and also like how reliable its measurements are. And then like we have to decide about the compatible data acquisition system. So there are various parameters which influence the design. Like it provides answers to specific questions such as load rating. We have to think about the structural characteristic, measurement needs, and selection of sensors, data acquisition system, data management. But not only that, the interpretation and dissemination of performance results, so that like you can have more confidence in the infrastructure system. The public will have more confidence in the infrastructure system. That is what we want to achieve with the structural health monitoring. Now, coming to the service life, like why do a bridge reaches the end of its service life? It is primarily due to material deterioration, because we all know that the bridges are exposed to different environment where it may be either marine environment or near to industries where there may be carbon dioxide with wetting and drying, then temperature, humidity. Bridges may be founded on soil containing sulfate, chloride, etc. Sometimes alkali-silica reaction may be also there, abrasion may be there because of the wave action on pier or varying action on the deck, or freeze-thaw cycles, maybe not very important for our country, but limited to only limited part. But there are various deterioration modeling for the corrosion, and there are two phases of corrosion, that is the corrosion initiation and another is the propagation phase, and these two are important in predicting the life of the structure. Though like there are many service life prediction methods and software available now, to name a few like Life 365, Claudif, Syncon, Durocrete, then there is an ISO 16204 model code, then there is another which is a Stadium software, and it can be used to predict the service life of the concrete infrastructure exposed to sea water or and where there is sulfate, and it is essentially developed for these Arabian countries where you have high heat also. So that is one patented software available for the service life prediction. But I thought that one should have a basis like how we do actually do it. Basically, in RC structures, the generalized cracking of concrete cover, that is indicated as the end of service life. So there are two aspects involved. That is the period required for carbonation front to reach the rebar, that is the initiation time for corrosion, T0, and the time required for the rust to build up around the bar to split the cover. That is the corrosion propagation time. So the T0 and T1, these two components, has to be estimated, and then from that we are able to predict the life of the structure. But there are various factors which influence the deterioration rate of concrete due to carbonation. It depends essentially on the quality of cover, the depth of cover, permeability, the type of binder what we use for the structure, how good is the curing, the density of concrete, then the water cement ratio and environment effects such as temperature and humidity. And here I want to say that in general, like the humidity condition in India is changing. And we found that the places like UP, there are many structures which are subjected to now corrosion due to carbonation, because the carbon dioxide in atmosphere is also increasing. And also the carbonation happens when the humidity is in a range between 50% to 70%. And maybe because of the sprinkler irrigation and all what we are using for the field, the humidity is increasing in the atmosphere. And that is the one of the reasons for the increase in the corrosion due to carbonation. And you know that this can be easily detected with the phenolphthalein test. And I'm sure that Dr. Kantharavu will address this. So I am not going into detail about it. And essentially, one can work out the deterioration rate of concrete cover due to carbonation. And then using that, we can work out what is the initiation time of corrosion due to carbonation using this equation 1 and 2. And this figure, this depicts like how the binder type influence the carbonation rate. And there are different type of binders, and also like whether the component is exposed to rain or not, and the concrete is air entrained or not, that also affects the carbonation rate. And here this shows how the grade of concrete, it affects the depth of carbonation. And one can work out if you know the depth of carbonation, what will be the age of the structure if you know the concrete grade which has been used for the structures. So these graphs, they will be useful in predicting the service life of the bridge structures. And This is a table which has been used to show you, like, depending upon the binder type. Binder type 1 is essentially the Portland cement, and type 2 is Portland cement with either 28% fly ash or 70% GGBS. How this influence the life of the structure when you have different grade of concrete with minimum cover, what is given here. You can see that like for binder 1, type 1, that is better with respect to the carbonation. And you can see that, like, with 40 mm cover, we achieve something like 72 for carbonation, and 45 mm cover, 147. So there is a range we can work out for the structure. Now, coming to the chloride attack on the structure, actually, we have to understand that for bridge, for different components, like, you have a different transport mechanism with which this corrosion happens. So you have to identify that which are the elements which are submerged, and which are the components, like, subjected to some tides, or which are there the portion of the component subjected to splash and spray, like that. So the transportation mechanism for all of them are different. And then if you know what is the chloride, like the time for initiation of chloride, that depends on rate of ingress of chloride into concrete, surface chloride concentration, depth of concrete cover, and threshold chloride level. Actually, some of the data which are required for estimating this has to come from actual field experiments, and probably we are lacking in that front. And there are fixed second law which can be used to calculate this particular initiation time for corrosion due to chloride attack. But as I told you, some of the software which I mentioned earlier, they use a probabilistic approach for arriving at, in working out the service life of the structure. So this table gives basically what is the threshold level of the concrete. Basically, like in the design codes also, there are certain limits stipulated, and one can use them in estimating the service life of the structure. So this slide basically shows, like, what is the how the surface chloride concentration that changes with the distance. So these are the values based on the measurement done by McGee, and this is useful for a height above sea level, that is 4 meter. And using these values, we try to work out, like, what are the corrosion rate if the exposure conditions are different for different water cement ratio and minimum cover. And from that, we worked out what is the corrosion initiation time for the elements with the various exposure condition. Here I would say that, like, with very severe, that is the maximum water cement ratio of 0.4 and minimum cement content of 380 kg per meter cube of cement and minimum cover of 50, with this diffusion coefficient, again, this has to come from the field data. For these values, it comes out to be something like 113 years. So one has to really think about, this is just to give you an idea how these parameters that is affecting the life of the structure. Now, the propagation time starts when the passive film is destroyed as a result of falling pH due to carbonation, because you knew that this carbonation-induced corrosion or chloride-induced corrosion, they are essentially electrochemical process. And the corrosion propagation, it depends on the corrosion rate and also it depends on the availability of water and oxygen at the steel surface and the concrete quality and cover. So the propagation time has been calculated for various concrete cover, diameter, rebar, and also you can see that if the rate is more, the propagation time is decreasing. The third aspect comes to the repair and rehabilitation, which is really challenging. And on the third day, we have a few lectures on it. And there are essentially minor and major repair. Now the question comes, when we are doing SHM, which is a proactive approach, why can't we do some preventive maintenance so that we don't have to go for a minor or like major repair? And essentially the strengthening methodology involves identification of distress from inspection or load carrying capacity evaluation module, whether there is a deficiency in flexure or shear. Then we identify the type of distress, quantification of the distress. Then we have to think about the possible rehabilitation or retrofitting techniques. And while deciding, we have to consider the site condition, urgency, cost effectiveness, possible longevity of the structure, and availability of expertise to execute that particular work. Then the methodology for adoption of each scheme. Then, like, we have the major strengthening schemes. I am not going into detail, like flexural strengthening, that is one structural problem. And flexural problem can be addressed by adding additional reinforcement in the tension zone and then place either cast in situ concrete or gunite the area with suitable mortar, or provide additional beams, provide external pre-stressing, which Mr. J.K. Goyal will be addressing these issues, and then provide externally bonded plate, either steel plate or epoxy on the bottom flange, and provide near surface mounted reinforcement. Then shear strengthening, again, one can do by enlarging the section, provide externally bonded plate by bolting or epoxy on side faces, and provide near surface mounted reinforcement on side faces. So these are some of the techniques which are in practice, and there are some advanced materials available, and Eurocode has come up with a very systematic, comprehensive method for the repair and rehabilitation of structure. Probably if we follow that, we will be able to solve many of our problems. Then comes the These are some of the visuals of the flexural strengthening. As you know that, like, whatever the steel plate of an FRP plate, we will have to put it on the bottom flange. And then, like, for the shear strengthening, it will have to be on the web. And external pre-stressing, you will hear from Mr. Goyal. So I think, overall, it's quite challenging work ahead for civil engineers, so that, like, we pay attention to our structures, we monitor the structures, and monitoring the structure will definitely help to identify some problem before it actually develops there in the structure. And then, like, the service life prediction, again, like, we have these two models, but with the repair material also, people will be interested in knowing how much the life extension will be there for the structure. Then the various techniques for strengthening and rehabilitation of structures. So I am sure that all of you will have a lot to hear during the next 3 days. So thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Dr. Navid, please. Unmute first. Dr. Navid, unmute.
Thank you, ma'am, for this very interesting presentation and enlightening us with your views on the overall structural health monitoring and other construction-related techniques. So some of the panelists have joined us during the presentation. I'll quickly introduce them first. Shri A.K. Sharma, who is the formal special director, Journal of CPWD, Shri K.P. Abraham, former chief engineer CPWD, Professor Tarun Kant, adjunct professor from IIT Mumbai, and Shri Sameer Sulekar, MD SS Build Chemical, and Shri J.K. Goel, who is our BES member. He is the senior principal scientist, CSIR, CRRI. So most of the questions we have tried to answer during the presentation only by in the chat itself. But some of the people who have asked a question regarding the corrosion, depth of corrosion, time of corrosion, so there will be a separate lecture for that by Dr. Kantha Rao. So he'll be addressing all these questions there. And Mr. Ravi Madan, he has asked for standardization done by IRC for visual inspection. Ma'am, can you take this question, please?
Basically, the BA committee, the maintenance committee of concrete structures, this is addressing this issue. And we have come up with this IRC SP40 and also the other code or IRC SP35 that is in progress. So that is being addressed now.
Okay, so another last question from the attendees, which I would like to take, is from Mr. Avinash. He's asking, can we attend post deteriorating problem at the time of designing mixed design?
Actually, like the Life 365, which I told you, that probably provide a tool to select the proper material and also the water cement ratio and the mixed design if we have a target life. So actually right now what we are doing is take into account the stress and durability, but probably many of the countries, they have moved ahead with the performance-based design. So probably for us also, we will have to do it in the future. But before we do that, we need to have a lot of data and research to be done. And then we have to identify the performance criteria, that is serviceability, serviceable limit state based design, the SLD, we may have to do it. But it will be a time-taking process for us now because we have not yet started it.
Dear friends and all the panelists, actually, we will take all the questions during our presentation. So let us start the first presentation. Okay, thanks to everyone for joining and let us enjoy all the session. Okay, thank you everyone.
Now I request Shri S.S. Geherbaji for taking his presentation on a sense of quality assurance protocol in infrastructure development. Gherba sir, please share your screen.
Madam, panelist also invite again.
Dr. Lakshmi, stop sharing your screen. You have to stop sharing. At the top.
Right, meanwhile, please introduce our new panelist for this session and all the panelists of this session.
Again.
A.K. Sharma ji, Patan sir.
It's okay now?
You are still visible. Your screen is shareable now. You can see your screen. No, oh, thank you. Must always stop now. Gavarji, start sharing the screen now.
My screen is not visible.
No.
Madam, meanwhile, you can introduce our new panelist, or even for this session panelist.
For this, session, we have Shri Jay Prakash.
Yes.
A.K. Sharma ji, former chief. Yeah. Former Special Director General CPWD, Shri V.L. Patankar.
Yes, sir. Are you okay?
Dr. Harshvardhan Subbarao.
Consultants.
Dr. Narayan Pal. who is from Odisha PWD, engineer Sri Achal Mittal, senior principal scientist CBRI Roorkee, and Dr. Rajiv Garg, who is the chief scientist CRRI New Delhi.
Sir, you are all welcome. So kindly share your views also at the end of this lecture of Sri Gaharwal ji. So I request Gaharwal ji to kindly start your presentation, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I start my presentation with my prayer, sincere prayer to the Almighty, that let the Almighty bless all of us to prevent us and to overcome this ongoing coronavirus crisis very perfectly and very quickly. Back to my presentation, I shall be talking about essence of quality assurance protocol in infrastructure development. This is my outline of the presentation mentioned in my slide, and I shall be taking one by one. Taking the opportunities of infrastructure development. Yes, the various venues, transportation sectors, housing sector, energy sector, agriculture sector, sports sector. The benefits are obvious, leading to the economic development of the country, increased mobility, and increased employment opportunities. And when the day is there, night is also there. Definitely opportunities are there, the challenges are also there. What are those challenges for infrastructure development? This I have rated. First is the safety. Second is the fulfillment of societal needs. Third comes the quality. Fourth comes the cost efficiency. And the latest one is the sustainability. The sustainable infrastructure involves developing roads, buildings, energy, and water infrastructure with due consideration to economic, social, and environmental implications. And when I say sustainability, it is the lower carbon and environmental footprints, protection of natural ecosystems, prove resilient to the challenging climates, optimize the use of natural ecosystems and their infrastructure services. These are the challenges. And now, let us go back to the quality protocol. What is the background for that? So I take you back to the infamous disaster of failure of Vivekananda flyover, Kolkata, 31st March 2016. The memories are very much there, records are there, and the lessons, they have been learned by the engineering fraternity and the society. This is the pictorial view. Another view, the disaster was such that not only at national level, but there was echoes at international levels also. Definitely, as per the requirement, investigations were carried out and lessons were learned. And this is the overall picture showing how the flyover led to the failure. And this is the whole scenario, means when the concreting was on and there were deflection on a particular pier, pier number 40, on the cantilever span, and concreting was done, adding to the askew type of loading and resulting in the failure. This is another view of the failure. On one hand, it is the complete rotation. On the other hand, it is the complete failure, initiation of the fracture. At the end of the investigations, I give your attention, I would like to draw your attention, the IIT Kharagpur report, December 2017. And that says that, in conclusion, by virtue of the poor contract, poor design, poor material, poor workmanship, and poor supervision, the disaster took place. And hence comes the role of the quality protocol. The quality, as the name familiar to each and everybody, be it be any product, everybody talks about quality. It stands in the number one position of wish list. But all these, they are derived from the ISO terminology. I will just go through and then quickly move forward. The quality, the totality of the features and characteristics of a product or services that bear on its ability to satisfy stated or implied needs we all have the feel of that quality. The quality control, the operational techniques of the controlling quality. Next is the quality assurance, all those planned actions necessary to provide adequate confidence that the product or service will meet the requirements and is essentially a system of planning, organizing, and controlling human skills to ensure quality. Since a number of students are also there in the webinar, to have a simple understanding between the difference between quality control and quality assurance. Say, for example, I take the case of performing a slump cone test of a concrete for workability. Then there are standards. IS code is there. IRC code also mentions about that. So, and there is a standard operators. So suppose I perform the test complying to the all the requirements of the CODEL provisions, and at the end of the day, sticking to the CODEL provisions, I get the results and I get the desired results. Say, for example, if I have taken M35 grade concrete and the desired workability is 100 millimeter and I'm getting the result of that, then I can say that the quality control aspect with respect to the performing of this slump cone test and getting the workability of 100 millimeter is strictly as per the mentioned quality control. What comes the quality assurance? Now I'll come back to the production of the concrete of M35 grade concrete. Now is the era of RMC. So when I say that production of concrete, a number of agencies are involved, the batching plant, and coupled with the machinery, interaction of the manpower, then comes the interaction of the raw materials, etc., etc. The quality assurance is there. The mentioned specification, be it be with respect to the materials, be it be the with respect to the mixed proportions, be it be the calibration of the batching plant, be it be the functioning of the other machineries, then transportation of the concrete through transit mixer, and ultimately delivering it to the site, and then performing the slump cone test and getting the results of workability 100 millimeters. Means that quality assurance is a system. If I have performed a slump cone test giving the workability of 100 millimeter, I am saying that this is exactly in conformance to the mentioned specifications and as per the contract conditions, then the quality assurance is the system which ensures that the delivery of exactly M35 grade concrete fulfilling the requirement of 100 millimeter. The next terms in this quality world, quality assurance plan. The QAP sets out the planned actions required for quantities, assurance, quality surveillance. Its quality assurance plan is nothing but a recipe, means set of instructions, how to do the things properly. The quality surveillance, then whenever there's a surveillance on the quality, that is the continuous monitoring and verification of the status of quality assurance activities to ensure that it is being followed, that is the quality assurance. The quality policy is formally documented statement of the management's intentions and directions as regard to the quality. Each and every organization means that is the objective, this is the quality policy. CSIR is also having a quality policy, and accordingly, compliance to that, we are performing this webinar. Then comes another term, quality audit. Audit, it's a managerial tool used for reviewing the whole or part of the quality system by internal or external agencies not connected with the operation of quality assurance plan. Means it is auditing to the quality assurance plan. In some, what is a quality system? We talk about different things. So there is a system, a total system of policies, management, responsibilities, internal and external control, testing and quality control, acceptance criteria, corrective actions, and documentations, all they are covered in a quality system. It emphasizes the overall organization structure, responsibilities, procedures, and processes for implementing the quality management. In totality, in ISO, we follow a particular procedure of performing our task. In a bridge project or a flyover project, quality system is in compliance to that. It is very much analogous to that. The aspect of overall management functions that determines the quality policy and implements it by such means as quality planning, quality control, and quality assurance within its quality system is referred to as the quality management. These are all the management principles applied to the construction industries. What are the different components of the quality system? These are the supplier's quality policy, purchaser's quality policy, internal quality systems, inspection and audits. These all components, they cover the entire activities happening in a bridge or flyover project. Elaborately, what exactly are the requirements of quality system? Starting with the management responsibilities and the quality system contract review. The contract for a bridge or flyover, that is the main legal document. I can say, if I give analogy to the Bible, it is not wrong. It is for the very important for all the stakeholders, be it the owning agencies, be it be the contractor or concessioner, or be it be the consultant. Then contract reviews, design control, document and data control, purchasing, control of customer supplied products, product identification and traceability, process control, inspection and testing, control of inspection, measuring and testing equipments, inspection and test status, control of non-conforming products, corrective and preventive actions, handling, storage, packing, preservation and delivery, control of quality records, internal quality audits, training, servicing, statistical techniques. Overall, suppose if we want to document the successful conceptualization and then execution of a bridge or flyover projects, all these activities, one way or the other, they are documented. How to do these things, what are their importance, what are the responsibilities, everything is defined in a quality system. A successful execution of a project very much depends upon this minimal deviation to the specified these policies or specified instructions, mentioned instructions. What are the objectives of this quality system? Starting with the safety, that comes at number one, ensure safe structures for the traveling public, user friendly and user safe, provide structures that are low maintenance for the life of the structure, prevent problems from occurring during construction, provide cost-effective solutions, prevent errors, provide consistency, and promote ingenuity. Means whatever possibilities of the, you can say, probable happening of the events, they are all covered in that. Now comes the quality assurance manual. If I say that if execution of a bridge or flyover project, if it is well documented and it is ensured that each and every written method or mentioned, specified or spelled out method is strictly translated into ground actions as per the mentioned instructions, then definitely the outcome of the quality is good. So naturally, when I say like this, then there has to be some written documents. So that comes the quality assurance manual. If you can say complete set of instructions. The quality assurance manuals provide a base document outlining the policy procedures, responsibilities, compliance, acceptance criteria, and documentation. Quality assurance manual should be prepared and accepted by all parties concerned before the start of the project. Whenever a project execution is a concern, definitely writing down or accepting the quality assurance manual is a very, you can say, it's a mutually acceptable document. It should be acceptable to the various stakeholders, namely the owning agencies, the contractor or concessioner, and the consultant. The constructability and the other influencing factors, they are the major parameters. And likewise, identification of all parties involved in the quality assurance and their internal relationship, internal quality assurance system of each party, levels of cross-checking, verification in case of multiple verifications, controls including system of inspection and audit wherever applicable, organization of personal responsibilities and lines of reporting for quality assurance purposes, criteria for acceptance, rejections including identifications of proper authorities for such decisions, inspection at the end of DLP, items to be covered in the maintenance manual, all forms of documentation. So these are all, you can say, various possible activities and their guiding principles. They are covered in the quality assurance manual. For bridges and flyovers, in overall four types of quality control, they are there. For bridges, it starts with the Q3 level. And for expressway, it is, you can say, more stringent, that is a Q4. The Q1 and Q2, that are the less important bridge and roadway projects. So this, as far as all the concepts are concerned, mainly I will say that whenever the quality protocol is discussed, definitely there comes a legal document into picture that is called the contract agreement, or if it is a BOT project, then a concession agreement, wherein all the stakeholders, that is the owning agencies, contractor, and the consultants, they have to put together their efforts for the successful execution of the project. Now, the quality protocol outcome, that depends very much how sincerely, how having minimal deviation from the written procedures in the contract agreement, the project has been translated into the grounds. Definitely, if I say that a project has to be translated into the grounds, there has to have certain deviations on account of the practical difficulties. So what are those difficulties? How to overcome that? That I shall be taking by case studies. So let us go to the case studies. Just to have more understanding between quality assurance and quality control, I will rate four, two more examples. This is a famous, I would say that infamous, whenever a disaster is explained, an accident is explained, it is not famous, it is infamous. So that is the spacecraft Challenger explosion, that the infamous accident where casualties happened, and India also lost Kalpana Chawla in that. And what was that? NASA Space Shuttle Orbiter Challenger OV-099 mission mentioned broke apart 73 seconds into its flight, leading to the details of its severe several crew members, which included 5 NASA astronauts and 2 payloads specialists. The aircraft disintegrated over the Antarctic Ocean or the coast of Cape Canaveral. Subsequently, the investigations were carried out, and it was found that the set of instructions which were decided, a quality assurance plan which was decided to launch the aircraft next morning. What happened? It was anticipated that the next morning at the place of launching, the climatic conditions, they were not friendly, and probably it was not taken into account for in the design of that space aircraft. And due to the compulsions, the concerned stakeholders better know, it was just aircraft was, you can say, took off. And since it was the violation of the quality assurance plan, ultimately it led to the failure of that space aircraft. So that is infamous but classical example of what happens when the quality assurance plan is not followed. The second case is a plus case. When the night is there, day has to be there. And this is a case in 2014, Leipzig in Germany, near the railway station, one bomb buried below the ground level of Second World War, it was located, and it was a live bomb. So the authorities thought that it is very important to explode it. And then they set out one quality assurance plan, and they estimated that let us make a 2 kilometer radius, and whatever the establishment, be it the industrial or residential, let us get evacuated because the human life is very costly. And they did that. Subsequent to that evacuation, the explosion of that bomb took place successfully, and 0 life loss was recorded. So that's a perfect example of following a good quality assurance plan and getting the quality results. Taking the first case study, that is the Meerut Tirah Great Separator of Ghaziabad, and I would like to share that CSIR CRRI, in addition to its R&D efforts and giving solution to the industrial problems, they also took up this challenge of third-party quality assurance. So this is the subject flyover in picture, showing the various pictorial views. Vicinity of that is the metro line, but three out of the four photographs that you can say where the flyover is shown, that is the Meerut Tirah Great Separator I shall be talking about. Salient features of the Meerut Tirah Great Separator, I am giving this example. If whatever the theory I covered, how successfully we executed that plan, so that I will demonstrate, and that will be also a message to the various stakeholders attending this webinar and whoever will see in the YouTube or other sources, that please follow a strict quality assurance plan to make a safe, user-friendly and quality structure. So these are the salient features. Great separator, total length of 400 meters. Out of that, viaduct portion 259 meters and approach roads having RE wall portion on both ends having total length 141 meters. Two ends, one is going towards Delhi, one going towards Ghaziabad, as mentioned here. Accordingly, the ends were named as Delhi end and Ghaziabad end. This is the configuration having two abutments and rest of the piers. It has only one box cutter span. Rest were having the precast pre-stressed concrete girders. Now, starting with the safety, my objective of showing these things, sharing this experience with you all, is how we implemented that quality assurance plan. Of course, clearly spelled out in the contract agreement between Ghaziabad Development Authority and the contractor Singla Constructions. And of course, the third party supervision consultant were CRRI. Starting with the safety, means it was ensured that at the beginning of the day, there has to be a safety drill where the safety supervisor used to just brief all the laborers and staff, the significance of having a helmet culture and safety belts, and then about having half an hour briefing session, they were departing to take on their various duties. The checking of the reinforcement, since the order of the slides is random, it is not feasible from presentation viewpoint that I should come back. So wherever the concern slide is there, I will just explain what is the significance. Whenever the reinforcement binding plan was there, it was thoroughly checked first internally and second by the supervision consultant. Cover blocks, it was ensured that proper grade concrete cover blocks as per the specified spacings that were in place. Wherever the workers, they were working at a height from ground level, wearing proper helmets, safety belts, and the reinforcement, you can say the support staging, that is scaffolding, etc. They are safe, properly bolted, having proper connections. Daily, there was a briefing of the bar cutting, you can say, persons by the bar bending, you can say the head, and explaining what is the to be taken today for the construction and what is the bar bending schedule and how to comply that. And subsequent to the briefing, they were executing their works. I mentioned that it's a precast girders, pre-stressed concrete girders were there, and the construction space, I'll show in some other slide that it was located in the urban area. There the surrounding places, they were having full limitations. So wherever the vacant space was available in the vicinity, that was given by the Ghaziabad Development Authority owning agency to the contractor for costing their girders. So first of all, proper leveling, giving the levels of that. so that there should not be any sag on the part of the precast girders. Proper leveling using the latest leveling instruments, and that was also checked up by the representative of the supervision consultant or the supervision consultant themselves. And the slide showing RE-valve portion, the approach portion that was dug out, and it is having a close interaction with the ongoing traffic. So there lies the issue of safety of the traffic passing. So proper instructions were given, and they were ensured that contractor used to follow that, so that there should not be any risk to the users, road users in the vicinity. And this was to facilitate, since it was a congested junction, to facilitate the traffic without any stoppage of that traffic. Regarding the testing, as per the contract conditions, the conditions were there. The contractor was to establish a laboratory. The supervision consultant helped the contractor to establish a laboratory at their site. Their regular checking of the calibration of their equipments, namely the tube compression testing facilities and other, you can say, material testing, they were regularly checked. Now this slide shows the third party testing. In addition to the testing by the contractor, on random basis, samples they were sent to CRI, and independent testing in the presence of the representative of the contractor that and the owning agency sometimes, as per their requirement, as per their wish, those third-party testing, they were also testing. And the results of the contractor's experimental laboratory and third-party testing, they were continuously being monitored so that to know whether they are in, you can say, a consensus or within the permissible limits of the acceptable deviations. And checking of the spacing of the reinforcement, the role of the supervision consultant exactly as per the approved drawing, the drawing acceptance, you can say, protocol followed as per the contract agreement was there. The contractor, the designer was designing, and it was the third party testing of the, you can say, vetting of the design by IIT Delhi. And then again, it was seen whether it is being exactly followed at the ground by the supervision consultant. Now, testing at the site, mostly the RMC, they were ready-mix concrete that was used. So they were having the testing at the batching plant. The supervision consultant used to visit the batching plant also to check their certificates, the health, you can say, of the batching plant, calibration certificates, their results. And then when the concrete was delivered at the site, again the field testing was performed in the presence of the supervision consultant, and compliance to the results within the acceptable limits, contractor was allowed to continue the concreting. Wherever the testing facilities, they were not available with the contractor at site, they were approaching for the third party testing other than CRI, then the representative of CRI, in the presence of the representative of the owning agency as well as the construction contractor, they used to, you can say, witness the test at the third party testing establishment. Contractors, they were followed. They were suggested to comply the strictly the guidelines of IRC codes, IS codes. This is an example where the discontinuation of the crash barrier that was proposed, and contractor was advised not to make any discontinuity in the crash barrier, and improvisation of the design was suggested. This is shown in there. And this particular projection was to facilitate the installation of the street light, checking of the reinforcement, and then even the erecting of staging, scaffolding, proper connection of the scaffolding before giving the contractor permission for concreting, their proper, you can say, alignment so that there should not be any longitudinal bottom deflections or lateral bulging, and there should not be any, you can say, loose joints to avoid any probable, you can say, accident that was ensured, and only after compliance to that, the concreting permission was given. The slide also shows that due to space restrictions, that you can say casting yard, or you can say the other storage, they were given to the contractor to place their construction materials, but it was ensured that keeping in view the seriousness of the matter with respect to, you can say, codal provisions, storage of the pre-stressing steel, that was done under the controlled conditions. One view where the laborers, they are working at the height, the helmet culture, and again their wearing of the scepter safety belts, that was ensured. Well, this is the complete picture. This is not from that site, but an ideal site, ideal storage, you can say, what should be the various features of the casting yards. So, suiting to the ground situations, all these, you can say, mandatory requirements, it was ensured that contractor follows that. And needless to mention that it all happened with the consent and cooperation of the union agency. Now, again, checking of the reinforcement, cube testing at the site. Left hand is the pile cap. Now here is a typical practical problem, because the quantity of concrete is more. So TM requirement means keeping in view the total anticipated concrete quantity. One has to plan whenever you are going for mass concreting, and the design does not permit the provision of cold joints or any joints in the construction, then contractor are asked to submit their concreting plan well in advance, ensuring availability of proper number of TMs in the vicinity, so that there should not be any discontinuation in the concreting. So this precaution was taken, and only after the contractor submitted the plan and ensured their, you can say, strict compliance, the concreting permission was granted. Similarly, casting of the pre-stress, pre-cast girder, again, the proper lateral bracing, so that there should not be any lateral bulging of the shape of the pre-cast girder. That's what that was ensured. We have proper curing of the various cast structural segments. And this is the pre-cast panels for RE wall. Again, it was ensured that the proper stacking of the pre-cast elements, and then continuous curing as per the codal provisions for 14 days, that was ensured. And this is the preparation for casting of the box girder span. One truss is there. Now, this truss, the contractor was asked to submit the design calculation for this, you can say, scaffolding, and giving all calculations, what is the total weight of the cast span, and what is the total anticipated deflection due to the load of that weight concrete, and then how much camber they have given. All these things they were asked, contractor was asked, they submitted, and then all the calculations were checked, convinced, and then it was permission was granted for concreting. But before that, while casting this you can say frame, special you can say sensitive points, means that connections naturally at site, this is the weak point, means if you due diligence is not given, then contractor takes the liberty of doing very temporary sort of work, but it leads to the serious consequences. So even the joints of this temporary structure were also checked with respect to their jointing or bolting or proper welding, and ensuring from all aspects, then the permission of concreting was given. While concreting, again, it was contractor was asked to submit the sequence, how the concreting will be starting, starting from the center and then proceeding symmetrically so as to avoid any eccentricity of the loading during concreting. And all the weight of the labors and the manpower on the, you can say, scaffolding and the reinforcement, all they were taken into consideration with respect to any probable deflections. And then only it was allowed. Another view of that, and very important, is the pre-stressing. So first of all, the pre-stressing means exactly pre-stressing, what is the degree of pre-stressing, what is the pre-stressing force, what is the pre-stressing scheme. Contractor was asked to submit the quality assurance plan. It is checked, it was checked. It was exactly in line with the approved drawing, and then proper calibration of the pre-stressing jacks, and then again, the pre-stressing results, they were seen by the supervision consultant very closely. Their permissible, you can say, extension, and then the results, whether they are complying to the IRC norms, and then only it was given a green signal. And you see some of the elements, the pre-stressing jack, this position is above the ground level. So contractor was also asked to submit the calculations, see how he is assuming that this arrangement is safe, means the lifting of the pre-stressing jacks and then allowing at the girder level and imparting the pre-stressing. All those, they were submitted, calculation was checked, and then only the permission was granted. Now, this is the lifting of the precast girders and then putting it on the cast pier head. But before that, I would like to go to this slide. And this is, again, not from this project, but just giving introduction to the concepts or the concept I'm just talking about to have a clear understanding. Now is the era of precast construction, but precast construction also gets associated with the, you can say, interaction with a lot of machineries. Say, for example, in this slide I've shown two things. Balance cantilever, it has nothing to do with this particular site, but what is the concept is that this balance cantilever on the left-hand side, it is exactly how it happens at the site. But allowing it at the site, first of all, you have to do the analysis. Whatever, you can say, temporary loads, they are coming, whether they are safe or not. If they are not safe, then it is not comfortable to go with that. You have to make certain changes. So first of all, you have to basically, you have to check the calculation of that theoretically. And then everything is all right, scheme is all right. Then you are seeing that even transportation of this precast segment to the site and then the launching, it involves lot of machinery. In the second slide also, this is a launching girder. Again, for concept understanding, I'm just mentioning it. A lot of machinery is there. Now, we are sitting here in the lockdown and we are just watching the webinar. Similar is the case of doing the analysis. Means sitting in AC rooms and we are just simulating the conditions at the site and then doing the perfect, nearly perfect analysis using finite element and advanced tools. And then we are coming out. But when I say that, is bridge engineering project. A project which is not translated into ground, the story is half. The more significant part is that having taken all precautions with a, we can say, a device which allows only minimal deviation, like computer analysis software. But again, when it comes to the actual launching, it involves the interaction with the machinery as shown here. And here comes, here also, transporting the precast segment, taking it to the site, again, the interaction with the machinery. And here is the my site, where again, you are seeing that two huge cranes are there, and they are in the process of lifting the girders. The first and foremost aspect is that I should know whether the machinery which I am going to use for lifting this thing, which is very important, because any error here will cost very heavy. So I have to check up whether the machinery which I am using is fit. That is, the health of the machinery is okay or not. So that is the health certificate of the machinery. So the contractor asked, from whichever source, the cranes, they were, you can say, involved, you please show the fitness certificates. They are properly calibrated or not. And then only after ensuring that they are properly calibrated with respect to all their connections, et cetera, then only the permission was granted to make use of that. But in addition to that, precautions were taken. Contractor was asked to submit the plan for execution with respect, because it was, you can say, the flyover was located in urban areas where in the adjoining portion, traffic was going on, road users were there. So their safety is also important. So contractors submitted a plan and strict compliance to that plan ensure successful launching of this girder. And this is a particular, you can say, many infamous accidents in our country have taken place in metros also, I would not name, but these precautions, which needs that whatever sophisticated analysis we have done, but if we are going to translate at ground with the help of a manpower, say at, you can say labors, etc., etc., then those precautions, whether the joints, bores, weldings, etc., etc., you can say proper safety with respect to the construction site and the adjoining area, that is ensured or not, that is to be seen. That's a very important point with respect to the quality protocol.
Mr. Gharwap, you have 5 minutes more, please.
Post to this construction, non-destructive testing tools are there. In addition to that, routine testing, non-destructive testing also ensures proper, you can say, compliance to the quality protocol. And this is bearings. Bearings means acceptance of the bearings. Then again, testing is very important as per the various codes, our IRC codes, IRC 83, series part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, depending upon the type of bearings. This is the witnessing the testing at the premises of the supplier. And this is the designer's, you can say, plan. Whenever it comes to the installation of the bearings at the site, then what is the approved drawings, bearing alignment plan, that strictly has to be followed. And to ensure that at site, wherever the ground staff is there, make it simple and then make it this plan, which is free bearing, which is, you can say, fixed bearings. Everything should be very clearly, and the person who is supervising, who is executing, should be having very clear-cut understanding of that, what they are doing. This is a vulnerable point. This is the expansion joint. Again, acceptance of the expansion joint, taking, you can say, witnessing or testing as the establishment of the expansion joint supplier. And if the need arises, then we can go for the third-party testing. This is another view of the RE wall. Again, to ensure that that QOP, quality assurance plan, is properly followed, then initially starting with the giving initial inclination, and then in the adjoining of these, you can say, RE wall panels, using baby roller instead of, you can say, big roller due to space limitations, not allowing that hand, you can say, compaction, using making use of that machinery. With respect to the quality assurance, making a proper catalog at the site so that as per the approved design, various lengths of the, you can say, whatever the RE wall reinforcement is there, they are properly taken and then they are properly placed and executed. So this marks my first case study. Very quickly, I will go to the second case study and then I will rest my voice. So this is a case where an accident took place, a BOT project on a national highway. National highway means this is the concessioner's, you can say, call for design. And then there has to be an independent consultant, independent engineer is there. So this was the alignment of the bridge. What happened? Various piers, they are shown. One, you can say, pier head was casted at pier number 22 with the help of a truss. And that truss was transported to the pier number 20. So this is the, you can say, success story on pier number 22. This is another view, very giving very clear understanding of that. But when it used on pier number 20, what happened? During concreting, 48 cubic meter of concrete was proposed to be used on the pier cap of pier 20. Before concreting, the reinforcement formwork, bracing, support, working platforms, railings were checked by the concessioner's project management consultant. Concreting using concrete pumps started at 9 a.m. on the day of accident, where the upstream side of the pier cap, concreting on the upstream side was completed and finishing was under progress. On the downstream side, when the concreting was going on, then accident took place and it led to the casualty. Investigations, they were carried out and it was found that the truss, which was used on pier 22 successfully, when it was transported to the pier 20, pier number 20, and as per the quality assurance plan, the contractor should demonstrate the load test of that truss and proper, you can say, checking of that design of that supporting truss by the supervision consultant that was overlooked. Even the perfect triangle configuration of the supporting truss was not there. There were inferior quality of, you can say, jointing was there, poor welding was there. And when the concreting was going on, this shearing of that poor welding took place and it led to the consequences resulting into an infamous accident and resulting to the, you can say, number of casualties. So the lessons were learned and the follow-up actions were taken. Supporting truss was rejected. It was redesigned. And then the proper connections and proper bolting, proper welding that was ensured, and subsequently the concreting took place. With this, I rest my voice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for taking all the practical issues related to quality assurance in the site. Now I request the panelists to share their views. First, I request Mr. Patankar to start with, and then rest of the panelists can also voluntarily share their views. Mr. Patankar.
Let us go to the next panelist.
Yeah, hello.
Ajay, sir is there. Okay, fine.
Okay, all right. Very nice presentation by Mr. Agarwal. the quality assurance requirements and how it has to be done. The only thing I'll like to add here to what he has said, that many structures which I visited, there were some failures. And he has very rightly pointed out that every step is required to be taken care of, and every step, how things will be moving, should be recorded. They should be followed. And there has to be a methodology whereby the three agencies, the client, I hope my video is coming up. Okay, all right. Okay, I think hopefully now.
The client,
as also the contractor, as also the supervision team, who are the three, you know, important element of that entire contract management framework. Put it down that what all is required to be done, and they should strictly follow that steps and see that everything is being done. Many times, whether the structure deteriorates or it fails, failure occurs. I have seen that this is one area which is hardly any given any importance. The people are not really very careful. It is very important that these things are required to be seen and followed very strictly. Many times some of the records that I have seen, and they are created, it very much clear from the records that we see that these records are created for the purposes of keeping the records. They find within the records, we find that there are, you know, inconformities, which very clearly indicate that things are not recorded, they are not actually recorded, and they are not gone through. So the people who are involved to go through this must understand the seriousness of this and must be trained to every step and record it that has been done and followed very carefully and categorically. Mr. Garwar talked about the projects where, because nowadays mostly the precast construction is being done, which hastens construction. But in precast construction, every step of, you know, storage of the precast element, how they are being stored, and when they are being stored, transported, how they are being supported, even after the support system, when it has been brought out to the site and it has been put in place, it should all be recorded, and the entire design has to be seen with reference to exact step-by-step methodology which is going to be followed during the construction process, right from casting and thereafter storage and taking to the site. Then they are put at the proper place, how exactly that entire construction is going to take place, because I have seen the support system keeps on varying from a project to project. And if that is not taken into account, including the time that is going to elapse, because sometimes I have seen the precast elements are done, but due to certain problems at site, there are delays. And these delays also have a huge impact on the structure, the behavior it is going to, because the creep, shrinkages, etc. will all depend upon how much is the time elapsed. So I think the entire quality assurance is not just to look into things as they are being planned. Every step, everything that has to be put in place, and they should be strictly followed. And the designer, as also the people who are doing the construction, have to work hand in hand. And there should be a proper coordination between. Many times the original designer, when we reach to the site and we do not have any interaction with the original designer, and we do not take his feedback as to if there is any change which is going to happen from the methodology or the sequence or the planned steps as were taken into consideration by the original designer, whether they are being followed or not. That's the only, with reference to this section, I would like to mention. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I'll just take a very quick question from the questions asked in the chat box. That's very quite relevant, actually. Sir, is there, it is by Mr. Tamjeed Ahmed. So he's asking, is there any quality check after the construction? Once the structure is ready, because you have, I think, most of the checks you have covered during the structure.
Yeah, I have already answered.
Sir, okay.
Few slides I mentioned by chance, by virtue of the length of the presentation, that non-destructive testing that came at the last. Non-destructive testing, which again tomorrow I shall be taking. So they are the tools. If any deviation is there, so we can have a check of that, and again we can plan for the follow-up actions.
So any other views from the panelists, sir, or else we'll proceed?
Okay, sir.
Can I? This is Dr. Harshwardhan.
Yeah.
Dr. Harshwardhan, please speak, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Namaskar, sir.
Yeah, namaste, sir. Greetings to all. There's a huge row of luminaries here. So I will keep a few points, just a few points. Am I audible and clear?
Yeah.
Okay. There are, quality is a teamwork. It cannot be addressed at an individual level or by individual actions. Quality is always teamwork of all the stakeholders involved. It's not only a cradle to grave, it's beyond a cradle to grave concept. That is, after you demolish the structure, what you do with the remainder parts that you get from it and sustainably utilize the aggregates or the recycle the steel and so. So it's even beyond a cradle to grave concept. Now, being a management type of approach, quality is enshrined in a management type approach. You refer to the ISO standards, the three standard series for management standards, as we call them in ISO. The ISO 9000 series, then the 14,000 series, which addressed environmental issues and brought a huge focus on sustainability in the management concept and the quality concept. And the newer ones, the 55,000 series, which are the asset management series, ISO 55,001 and 2. And these asset management standards are the absolute acme or the pinnacle of enshrining quality systems. So the 55,000 series deals with asset. Anything is an asset. You know, your forests are an asset, your bridge stock is an asset, your road stock is an asset. So the people in that involved are also assets. So the whole asset management system is now enshrined in 55,000 series. And for example, one of the Chennai Metro Rail is adopting the 55,000 series for their entire quality system and quality approach. So these are some of the things I wanted to, there's a asset management Institute of Asset Management online, and you can go and have a look at these 55,000 series issues. But the most telling thing for my young engineers here is to show that the Ultadunga flyover, I think many of you might have seen that classic photograph of a span collapsed and fallen down. A box girder, very good in torsion and very good on a curve, had simply, it had just completely come off and fallen down one full span, making that flyover useless. Now, why that happened was not adhering to quality standards. Quality standard at that time, the quality management system failed. Why? Because at the time of installation, the bearings were manufactured perfectly, everything, concreting was good for the piers, everything was done, fabrication of the steel spans were superb, everything done. But in placing the bearings, because of the curve, there's an uplift on one side. They simply put the uplift bearing on the opposite side of the two bearings on the pier. They exchanged the location of the two so that the uplift was not catered for on that curve, and we lost a span. So this is where quality always evidences itself when there are failures. From failures, we learn a lot. And that was also being brought to the fore by Mr. Gawar. And I leave this thought with my young engineers. If we have a good quality approach, I would say system, standards, and people, processes, if we have a good quality approach, 90% of major failures will stop happening in the world of bridge failures. And we are seeing a number of them these days, especially bridge decks. You know, Hero Honda Chowk, you know, in Delhi, so many bridges, flyovers, in fact, all over in Lucknow, so many places, the bridge decks have failed. That is, everything else was done well, but at the time of concreting the bridge deck, pouring RMC into the bridge deck, something went wrong. So a quality system has to be traceable. Traceability is very important. Otherwise, you can never learn from how it had failed and how it can be changed for future lessons to be learned. So this is what I want to stop with, sir. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
There are actually so many questions pouring in the chat box. We are trying to answer them side by side, but if there are, some of them are remaining, we'll try to answer them through email. So now we would like to proceed to our next lecture by Dr. Vivial K. Kanta Rao. It is on durability of concrete failure mechanisms and service life prediction models.
Okay, so before that, we can hear the views from A.K. Sharma or Shishir Bansalji.
Okay.
Ask them to share with these also.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Ekashima, sir, please.
To my understanding, whatever this quality assurance system must have a written documentation. And because there are many stakeholders in quality assurance system, so everybody should create a document of the quality control check at the appropriate time. So with this, this is what my comment on the entire presentation is. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Shishir Bansal, sir. Can you hear me? Okay, Dr. Navid, go ahead.
So in the next presentation, we have in the panelists, we have Professor Jay Prakash, who is the former Vice Chancellor, GLA Mathura. Mr. K.P. Abraham, who is former Chief Engineer, CPWD. Dr. I.K. Pateria, Director Technical, NRIDA. Sri Samir Sulerkar, MD of SS Build Chemicals. Mr. Shishir Bansal from CPWD. And Mr. Sanjeev Kumar, who is Chief Engineer of MOAT, and Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran, who is Chief Scientist of CRRI. I request Dr. Kanta Rao to share his screen and start with the presentation, please.
Are you able to see this slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon.
Rao, just a minute. We are not able to see your screen. We can see your screen, but not the slides.
Yeah, there is only screen.
Only screen, no slides.
No slides.
Just sir, first slide open, then share, sir.
You open your PPT.
First पर PPT ओपन कीजिए आफ्टर दैट यू शेयर द स्क्रीन नो स्टॉप यू प्रेस द स्टॉप शेयरिंग बटन नाउ
नो आई जस्ट I opened it actually. I'm able to see it.
No, we are not able to see it. Only your screen slot is available.
Okay, okay.
Dr. R, at the top of the window, there is a button. Stop sharing.
Stop sharing is there, yeah.
You press that button.
I stopped it.
And then open your this one, PPT. And after that, you start sharing your window. Start sharing a window now. There is so many options will be there. Which window you want to show? And you click on that window. Yes, we have not got it.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, now we got the slide.
Yeah. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
It is also R&D, sir.
Yeah, that's it. Good morning, all of you. My dear panelists, my dear colleagues, and my dear attendees. The title of this lecture is Durability of Concrete, Deterioration Mechanisms, and Service Life Prediction Models. I'll be briefly discussing all these aspects in this 1 hour time given to me. Please bear with me. The outline of my presentation is, first I'll discuss about durability of concrete and the factors affecting the durability and effects of poor durability. Deterioration of concrete, what is it? And its mechanisms, and then effects of concrete deterioration on structures. Mostly, I'll be talking about corrosion after discussing with about other deterioration mechanisms. And I'll touch upon the service life prediction and estimation models. In fact, Dr. Lakshmi Madam has made my life simple by talking in detail about these models and the prediction estimates. I have taken, of course, some liberty. Took liberty in taking some pictures from the internet. Now, what is the durability of concrete? It is basically the ability of a concrete structure to last for a long time without any significant deterioration under a given exposure conditions. This is the important aspect. In any given exposure conditions, our concrete structure should be able to last for a long time without any deterioration. Different concretes will require different degrees of durability depending on the exposure and the environmental conditions and what properties we want. For example, the concrete exposed to tidal seawater will have a different requirements than a concrete which is in indoors, which is not exposed to any environment. So that way the requirements will vary. Basically, the durability is the capability of a concrete to resist weathering action, chemical attack, abrasion, or other such actions while maintaining the desired engineering properties. It normally refers to the duration of or lifespan of the trouble-free performance also. Now, why should we need a durable concrete? What is the need? Because a durable concrete material will help us conserving the environment resources and reducing the waste and environmental impacts on repair of and replacement. Suppose if there is a bad structure is there and we want to repair it by removing a part of the structure, that means we are generating some waste there and that is going to damage the environment. At the same time, for repair of that structure, we need some extra material, some cement, aggregates, other materials. These are again, they will cause damage to the environment. They are energy demanding materials. So that way we are actually damaging the environment. So we want a durable material to help the environment to conserve and last long. That is the basic idea. Now, what are the causes of lack of durability? We talk durability, but lack of durability means what? Concrete structures are subjected to different actions, physical action and chemical action. Because of this, the concrete loses its durability. What are these actions? Physical action, freezing and thawing action, percolation or permeability of water, temperature stresses, or heat, high heat of hydration, or exposure to high heat of environment. Chemical action, I just put them in alphabetical order, not in the importance this thing. Alkali aggregate reaction, corrosion of reinforcement, sulfate attack. These three are the chemical actions which are mainly responsible for lack of durability of the concrete. What factors affect the durability of concrete? Many are there. Like starting from the beginning of the design of this the structure to the and its construction and putting into service. Cement content. If you are using a low cement content, you will end up with a low strength concrete. At the same time, if you are using a high cement content, you will end up with a cracks, shrinkage cracks. So you should be able to use optimum content of cement content. Aggregate quality. Poor aggregates will have impact on the durability of the concrete. It's like poor bones. If you have got bad bones, we don't have so much of strength actually. The aggregates will give the shape to the concrete structure. So they should be of good quality and good properly graded also. Water quality. If the water has got any contaminants, it's going to spoil your concrete and it's going to affect your cement hydration and its properties. So that way quality also should be good. Concrete compaction, it's very, very important. If the compaction is not good, then you are going to end up with a poor quality concrete and you are going to have a bad durable concrete. Curing period, curing also. Curing is very, very important. If you can't, it should be a part of the construction of any structure. Curing should be done and very important. Otherwise, you won't get the strength of the strength for the concrete. Permeability, this also will have a bad quality concrete will have a high permeability. Permeability is different from porosity. Every concrete will have some porosity, some pores will be there. But if the pores are not interconnected, then concrete will have a less permeability. That's what we want actually. Pores may be there, but they should not be interconnected. That kind of concrete we want, that it will have less permeability. High permeability means poor durability. Moisture. It should not be exposed to a lot of moisture or water. Otherwise, what happens? The water will enter into concrete, remove the our soluble salts in the concrete, like calcium hydroxide, and then it will lose its durability. High temperatures. Temperatures also will affect the durability. Rust is abrasion. Abrasion will have, we know, in the dams and all, the top surface goes off and the reinforcement gets exposed and the concrete will lose its strength. Carbonation. Carbon dioxide will enter into the concrete and it will spoil the concrete. That way, and in fact, it will increase the shrinkage of the concrete. That's called carbonation shrinkage. And that leads to cracking of the concrete. Wetting and drying cycles, again, they will have a lot of effect on the durability. Freezing and thawing, alkali aggregate reaction, sulfate attack, and organic acids. All these factors will affect the durability of the concrete. Just a few examples I am giving. This bridge, like Ms. Gharwar said, unfortunate thing. It's a bridge gutter in which we inspected in Delhi some few years back. You can see the reinforcement. But you can put your hand also on the bottom of the gutter. That is the kind of poor quality construction or compaction was done. So this kind of things we should not encourage. Other things, the moisture, as I told you, because of moisture or water, the calcium hydroxide will come out and form a white patches on there. That's called efflorescence, and some later it will lead to cracking also. On the right hand side here, you will see the cracks because of the thermal gradient. That if outside are concrete and inside concrete has got a lot of difference in the temperature, then that leads to thermal cracking. Freezing and thawing, again, concrete will develop cracks and the mortar will go away, aggregates will get exposed here. And on the right-hand side, if you see here, sulfate attack. This is the residential building of a, footing of a building, and it got exposed to sulfates, and I will discuss about, in detail later, and it got damaged. So these are some of the examples of the poor durability of concrete. This acid attack, any acid like sulfuric acid, hydrochloric acid, or nitric acid, if it is exposed, if they fall on the concrete, then this kind of damage will take place to the concrete. So we should be careful about that. Now, what is the, if you go back to the cement concrete to understand this durability mechanism, we all know that this Portland cement has got four major components: calcium, tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, tricalcium aluminate, tetracalcium aluminum ferrate. These four. These two are the strength giving elements: tricalcium silicate and dicalcium silicate. When you add water, what happens? This cement forms calcium silicate hydrate. It is also called tobramorate gel. And along with that, calcium hydroxide is formed. It's a byproduct of the cement hydration. You cannot avoid, because the during manufacture itself, this sodium and potassium and calcium, they enter into the cement manufacturing stage, and they are there in the cement as a part of the materials. So the calcium hydroxide is a byproduct here. And also the tricalcium aluminate, other component of the cement, after hydration will form calcium sulfur aluminates. These are the major components of the hydrated cement. Apart from that, we have got gel pores of 1 to 5 nanometers and capillary pores of 10 nanometers to 10 microns. These capillary pores are very, very dangerous, and they actually affect the durability of the concrete. If you see the cause of concrete deterioration in a plastic state, there are two phenomena that take place during construction. And which when we are not, if we are not careful about it, then they may lead to cracking at the later stage. That's called, one is the plastic settlement, other one is the plastic shrinkage. Settlement is the one first you will see actually within a few hours. Shrinkage also, you will see plastic shrinkage. Whenever there is a lot of bleeding, and when temperature is very high or wind is very high, so you will get this kind of shrinkage cracks. In the hardened state, there are many reasons are there, like drying shrinkage, thermal movements, corrosion of reinforcement, alkali silica reaction, or alkali aggregate reaction, or whatever I said earlier, sulfate attack, frost attack, abrasion or erosion, fire damage. So many causes are there. We'll discuss some of them later. In fact, the Concrete Institute of America says that it is unrealistic to expect crack-free concrete. That's what they say actually. So cracks normally they form. It's only the size of the crack that's going to affect our durability, right? It's a very famous picture of concrete society, and you can see here some of the cracks are like shrinkage cracks and all. Here it is shown here. These are the shrinkage cracks, and some of them are corrosion related cracks. Any deterioration, any problem in the concrete will reveal itself in the form of a crack. Like we human body, any infection we got, there is a temperature. Suddenly we get temperature because there is an infection in the body. Similarly, if any distress is there in the concrete, deterioration is happening, it will reveal itself in the form of a crack. So these are different cracks. These cracks are thermal cracks. This is a drying shrinkage crack here. You can see here, if you are able to see, and these are all shrinkage cracks. These ones are, and this is settlement crack. These were, and here also, and these are actually these settlement cracks are corrosion cracks because of steel reinforcement corrosion. This is how the shrinkage cracks looks like. Plastic shrinkage cracks, the usually about 1 to 3 feet apart, generally parallel to one another, these ones. And sometimes they can go up very deep also into the concrete. These are all the shrinkage cracks. If you take a concrete core actually, you can see how they penetrated into the body of the concrete. These are all actually shrinkage cracks here, if you can see here. So this is a drying shrinkage. This again, it's restrained to shrinkage provided by the subgrade. It's a crack on the concrete pavement. Because of any subgrade restraint providing to the concrete expansion or contraction, will lead to cracks in the concrete. drying sinker. This is a newly laid concrete actually. This is a old concrete if you see, and this is a hard concrete. A new concrete is getting contacted and is giving a restraint here. So you are getting a drying sinkage crack here actually. This is a drying sinkage. The other mechanism, basic mechanisms of deterioration are, as I told you, corrosion of steel reinforcement and alkali silica reaction and sulfate attack. In the sulfate attack, there are four different parts are there. Okay, so if you see corrosion, what is corrosion? Corrosion is basically the disintegration of a metal on reaction with the environment, which is in contact with it under suitable conditions. This is very, very important. Under suitable conditions is important. Otherwise, it won't corrode. But thing is, all metals corrode. Very, very important. It's only the rate of corrosion differs. Gold will corrode very slowly. That's why it's very costly. And steel corrodes very fast. That's why we are using it in concrete. I'm sorry for that. Okay? So, tendency to revert back to naturally occurring state. Because the iron or the steel, whatever we make, we are getting it from the mother earth, from the iron oxide raw material. We are actually treating it with a lot of heat and all, and making it to iron and then steel. So it always tends to go back to its original state. That is called iron oxide, by giving away that energy actually. So the tendency to go from high energy to low energy state, that is what basically corrosion. And also I tell you, this rusting, you keep listening to this word, rusting, that is basically associated with corrosion of the iron or steel. That's called rusting. Other metals, we call it corrosion. Aluminium, corrosion. We don't say aluminium rusting, we don't say like that. Or copper rusting, we don't say. Copper corrosion, like that. So rusting is a word associated with steel basically, of corrosion. Now, as I told you just now, from iron oxide, we prepare extract iron by giving heat treatment, and in the corrosion, what happens? This iron gives away that energy in the form of electric current to form iron oxide. That is where it leads to it undergoes corrosion naturally. Basically, this corrosion of steel is a electrochemical reaction. This involves both generation of electric current. In the form of we can measure it, electrical potential or electrical current, and it also forms chemical reaction products. These two are the major results of this electrochemical reaction. Now, the question is, why this steel undergoes corrosion? What triggers actually? Why it undergoes corrosion? We see very common, very very good looking steel, but wait, and what is the triggering factor for corrosion? You see, when we see a steel bar, we see it's normal, it looks like very common, very uniform. But the thing is, it have a differences in composition within that steel bar, suppose. We know that it has got iron, carbon, and other materials. These are not uniformly distributed, you see. So that's why at some places, some differences in composition you will come across. That is the triggering factor actually for corrosion of steel. Similarly, on the steel, there are different grain boundaries are there in the chemical structure, in the composition structure of the steel. They also they trigger changes in the environmental conditions in the vicinity of steel, in the concrete, mind you. In the concrete, the steel is not in a uniform environment condition. At some places, oxygen may be more. At some places, it may be less. Similarly, moisture may be very high at some places, and it may be low at some places. These are the actually things which actually trigger this corrosion. And the other one is applied stress in the steel. If you don't apply uniform stress on the steel, it happens actually. That also leads to corrosion. Because of this one, what happens on surface of the steel, two spots are created, active spots. What is called? They are called anode and cathode. These two active spots are created because of this triggering factors that leads to corrosion. Okay. So what happens because of corrosion, what's happening on our steel and RCC? The level of corrosion of a metal of the steel is often expressed in terms of percent loss in its weight. Because of the steel corrosion, it loses its weight, right? So at 5% corrosion level, percent loss in weight, the yield stress of steel is decreases by about 7.4%. And its ultimate stress decreases by 8.6%. This is the effect of corrosion on the properties of the steel bar. At 20% corrosion results in decrease of yield stress by 22.2% and yield stress by 31.8%. So, when iron bar corrodes in the concrete, its volume actually increases from by about 5 to 7 times actually. So up to 6 times also, it will increase. Because of that, there's no space in the concrete to accommodate this increase in the volume. That leads to cracking. That creates pressure in the concrete. Tensile forces will increase, and that leads to cracking in the concrete. You see here, as the steel corrosion increases, its yield stress is decreasing here, and also it become brittle actually. Its elongation is decreasing, and it's becoming brittle. Similarly, you can see here, with increase in the metal loss, the strength of the concrete, yield strength and ultimate strength, both are decreasing. This is the effect of the corrosion on the properties of the steel bar. Now, in the case of concrete, what's happening? As I told you, because of the corrosion, there's an increase in the volume of the steel bars here. And because of this increase in the tensile forces in the concrete, cracks formed actually. These are the cracks, and after some time they get connected to each other, and this part gets separated from the rest of the body. So first cracking happens, and then this part gets separated. That's called delamination, separation of concrete from reinforcement bar. This is called delamination, and then this part falls off. That's called spalling. You know, the expansion action of this internal pressure, it will go up to 20.7 megapascal, you know. And whereas the tensile strength of our concrete is only about 4 to 5 megapascal. That's why the concrete cracks actually, and spalling takes place. In the case of RCC, as the level of steel reinforcement corrosion in RCC member increases, the crack width on concrete surface increases, and consequently, its load carrying capacity decreases. A 22.4% level corrosion resulted in the reduction in the flexural capacity of RCC beam by 8.8%, while 9% level of corrosion results in 17.6% reduction in the flexural capacity. The stiffness of concrete member decreases linearly with the loss in the cross-section of the steel. A 1% loss in cross-section of steel corresponds to 0.6% loss in the stiffness. So the concrete member loses its stiffness, and that results in the ultimate degradation of the concrete. You can see here, with the degree of corrosion increasing, the load carrying capacity of the RCC being decreased here. This is one more, the flexural moment also decreased with the increase in the degree of corrosion, right? A few of the examples here, what we have come across. These are actually, you know, these are simple mild steel bar was used at that time during construction of this bridge pier. But this also got corroded, you know, because at this location, lot of that roadside vendors were preparing food and all. So that led to the conditions conducive to reinforcement corrosion here, and that led to cracking here. Otherwise, mild steel is generally less corrosion prone compared to a high yield steel bar, actually, HYSD bar. Some more examples of the effects of corrosion on concrete structures. You can see these all spalling happened, and the reinforcement bar exposed. It's a bridge we inspected in Kerala, and you can see here the pile has completely vanished here. You can see from bottom because of the corrosive environment. This is one more bridge in Kerala. and on the top of the deck there was a pothole through which water was leaking and coming onto the precised gutter here and creating corrosion and exposure of reinforcement bar here. You can see here, you can see here, cracks are there actually. Whereas I tell you, the piers of this bridge were excellent, they were intact. Only because of this problem in the deck, water seeping from the top, this precious concrete gutter is getting corroded and cracks are developing. Piers were excellent and they were in good condition. Taking a cue from Gaherwar, this is unfortunate events of collapses of bridges due to reinforcement corrosion. In West Glamorgan in England, 1985, one bridge came down because of corrosion of the steel tendons at joints between the precast segments. And one more bridge in Hampshire, England, also it's a foot bridge, collapsed in 1967. And one bridge in Belgium, collapsed in 1992, Malay Bridge. Malay Bridge, of course, Madam Sajid mentioned in the morning in her lecture. And what is the cost of this corrosion on infrastructure? The government of India has announced the National Mission on Corrosion Control Technologies and Standards, you know, to actually understand, to make a study on the impact of this corrosion on the cost of the infrastructure. It was reported that India corrosion is impacting about 4.2% of the country's GDP. 2019 study actually, I'm quoting, and in US also 3.4% of its global domestic product is affecting the infrastructure of the US actually there. Some other studies I'm not going here. But thing is, this cost of corrosion consists of all aspects of the infrastructure, not just the bridges. There's no concerted effort to estimate the cost of corrosion associated with the bridges or flyovers and other construction infrastructure in India. Whatever I'm telling is 4.2, some industries are there and many other structures are there, which actually also getting damaged because of the corrosion. That's all contributing is 4.2% of the country's GDP. Now, if you look into the mechanism of corrosion, as I told you, this anode and cathode sites are created on the steel bar here. It is at the anode the corrosion takes place. The metal loss takes place at the anode only, not at the cathode. At the cathode, a supporting chemical reaction takes place to sustain this anodic reaction here, this loss of metal. If you see again here, at anode, this metal loss is taking place here, and at cathode, nothing is happening there. Suppose if you make your steel bar as a complete cathode, it's a good idea, no corrosion at all, no problem, it can be done. There are many methods are there. So that way, you can actually stop the corrosion. You can completely stop the corrosion if you make your steel bar a cathode. In this actually, in the process, of corrosion, what's happening, as I told you, at the iron, metal loss is taking place, and at the cathode, this electrons, whatever are there, are getting consumed here to form hydroxides. And these two iron and oxides, they form iron hydroxide. That is basically rust or corrosion. You see here, beauty here is you need oxygen and water to sustain this corrosion reaction. If you stop these two into your concrete, oxygen and moisture, there is no corrosion. But is it really possible for that? No, you can't do that. It's not possible. That's why corrosion is an inevitable deterioration process which happens in concrete. But again, the question comes, is my steel bar will start corroding the moment I put in the concrete? No. Actually, concrete will have a lot of alkalinity because remember that calcium hydroxide is there. It gives a lot of pH to concrete, about 12 to 13 pH, very high alkalinity. So in that alkaline nature, the concrete actually, the steel bar is protected. It forms an iron oxide layer on the surface and it gets protected. as long as that pH is there, maintained, nothing will happen to your concrete. Of course, the other problem is there. So this iron oxide layer is stable only in high alkaline conditions and in the absence of chlorides. These two are important. If alkaline conditions are not there or get damaged, then iron oxide layer will get damaged and corrosion will start. Similarly, when chlorides enter into concrete, even in the presence of high alkalinity, corrosion will take place. So these two are the mechanisms of why iron corrodes in the concrete. So this loss of passivity will take place in the presence of chlorides or chloride ingressed, what we call, and carbonation of concrete. Madam discussed in detail about this carbonation phenomena, but briefly I also will touch upon to for continuation sake. You can see here, because of chlorides actually, the corrosion will start at a very early age. Can be 5 years also. Within 5 years also, you can see corrosion if your concrete quality is bad in the presence of chlorides. But of course, carbonation will take a longer time, but that also will deteriorate your concrete. These two are responsible for corrosion of the steel rebar. So this is the mechanism of chloride attack. I will not go into, but how these chlorides enter into concrete? That's the important question. As a contaminant in the constituents of concrete, maybe your water is contaminated, or your aggregates or sand may be contaminated. Because of this, the salts can go into concrete and they may damage your concrete. They start the corrosion of the reinforcement. Similarly, when your structure is in the marine environment, like sea coast, there also you are getting lot of salts. Basically, salt means sodium chloride. That enters into concrete. The chlorides will enter into concrete and they will damage the concrete actually. Or from industrial environment, if any industries are there containing these chlorides, then they also can, that time also chlorides can enter into concrete. And between normal steel bar and pre-stressing steel bar, pre-stressing steel is very, very vulnerable to corrosion. We have to be very, very careful about it. This is the one actually responsible for that corrosion of that Mandevi bridge. So which madam has were talking about in the morning. Now, these chlorides are two types in the concrete actually. When you test for any concrete for chlorides, we'll come across these two nomenclature. Water-soluble chlorides, acid-soluble chlorides. Normally, this is what we test in the laboratory. Acid-soluble chloride, most likely, this is what we test actually. Acid-soluble chlorides. This is also called total chlorides. Sometimes you will come across in the literature. The water-soluble chlorides are also called free chlorides. The difference between these two is that the water-soluble chlorides, they simply pass through the pore structure, pore water, and directly reach the reinforcement level. So they are more vulnerable, that they make more damage to the concrete. But in the case of acid-soluble total chlorides, a part of the chlorides actually, they get absorbed to the calcium aluminate hydrate, C3A hydrate product actually. So it binds some of these chlorides, and only few chlorides, they enter into the water-soluble system actually. That's why you will get this acid-soluble chlorides are called total chlorides, and these are called free chlorides. You see here, because of this water-soluble chloride, if you measure it, as the chloride content increases, you will see the higher rates of corrosion of the steel bar compared to acid-soluble. Because some bound chlorides are there, that they are not contributing to the corrosion here. All water-soluble chlorides will contribute to the corrosion. Similarly, any chemical reaction, corrosion also is a chemical reaction, as I told you. So any chemical reaction follows that Arrhenius equation. It increases, its rate increases with temperature. So as the temperature increases, the rate of corrosion also will increase. Also, if there's a dry concrete is there, resistance of concrete means dryness or the easiness with which ions can pass to the concrete. So if it is a dry concrete, then the corrosion rate will decrease actually. Because you remember, between anode and cathode, there is a transfer of ions through concrete pore actually. If the concrete is dry, the ions cannot travel because they have traveled through water or pore water actually. So if it is dry, they can't travel. So the corrosion rate will decrease actually. That's why in dry environments, the corrosion rate is less compared to wet environments. Now, how much chloride is required to start the corrosion? That is the question actually. The chloride actually will enter into concrete from its surface. They travel all the way through the cover concrete and then reach the reinforcement. And then they will depassivate the steel bar. That is the mechanism basically. Right, so it's not that a small quantity of chloride has gone into concrete and the iron bar starts corroding. It's not like that. There is a minimum amount of chlorides required to reach the level of reinforcement to start depassivation and start corrosion actually. So that's called threshold chloride. The minimum amount of chloride is required to break the passive oxide film. It depends on the details of concrete mixture and exposure conditions. And it is expressed in terms of mass of concrete actually, percentage mass of concrete. So this threshold chloride primarily depends upon the type of steel actually. This the passivity of steel gets broken because of chlorides, and this passivity will depend upon the chemical structure of the steel. Suppose normal TMT bar is there and zinc coated bar, galvanized bar is there, or stainless steel bar is there, they will have different threshold chloride contents actually. That's why you will see in the case of steel reinforcement structures, the corrosion will take at a longer period compared to a TMT bar, which takes place in at a shorter period because of that protection given by the stainless steel bar to the from the corrosion actually. So it is generally accepted. In fact, if you see literature, there's a lot of variation in the threshold chloride content. Some people are say 0.2%, some people say 0.02%, and some people be 1%. Lot of variation is there. Still lot of research is going on, and currently it is accepted that up to 0.4% by weight of cement is considered safe, and above that corrosion will start. So generally 0.4% is taken as the acceptable the limit beyond which some people may contradict me on this in the panelists, but this is the, in the literature says that this is the acceptable content. But of course literature, a lot of study is going on to determine this minimum chloride content to initiate the corrosion. Suppose you don't know the weight of cement in your concrete in a old structure, some 20 years old structure. We have a bad habit of not maintaining the records properly. So we don't have any records of what concrete was used and how much cement was used. So you know, only you can only get some sample of concrete. So if you know that, then this is what is applicable. 0.6 to 0.83 kg of chloride ions per cubic meter of concrete. This is the limit. If it is beyond that, then corrosion will start. If you know cement content, this is the limit. Otherwise, this is what criteria we normally follow. So different people have given different criteria. As I told you, the RILEM has given 0.9 to 1.2 kg per cubic meter of chloride content. This is as per 235 CTC. It might have changed now. ACA criteria has given a different criteria. And most of them give water soluble chloride, and some people give acid soluble chlorides. That also you have to be careful. You should look into the document properly. Our IRC 112 also gives a minimum chloride content. This is acid soluble chloride for RCC 0.2% by weight of cement, and prefab concrete 0.1% by weight of cement. This is the recommended values in IRC 2011. 4, 5, 6 has given some other values, and see, as I told you, it depends on the quality of concrete. Will have a lot of impact on the durability of the structure. If your concrete is very good compacted and the pores are not interconnected, it will take a lot of time actually for chlorides to reach the level of reinforcement. Like this 0.4 water cement ratio concrete will have a very good compact structure. It will take a lot of time for chlorides to reach the level of reinforcement. On the other hand, if you have got a poor quality concrete, then at a very faster rate, the chlorides will reach the level of reinforcement, and then corrosion will start at a faster rate. It's also same thing. And the other mechanism is carbonation. Madam has discussed, of course, in detail. What happens here is the carbon dioxide in the environment, it mixes with the water. I don't say reaction, it mixes with water and forms what is called carbonic acid, right? And that gets deposited on the surface of the concrete and slowly will enter into concrete. Two pores, as I told you, pores are there all over the concrete. And it reacts with the calcium hydroxide in the, calcium hydroxide in the concrete. It is already there in the, actually in the concrete. These two will react to form what is the calcium carbonate. Forget about this product, but with this what happens, the pH of the concrete is reduced. You remember, one is chlorides, other one is reduction in the pH. This is what is happening here. The pH of the concrete will reduce and that leads to depacification of the steel and that leads to corrosion of the concrete. But this is a long period it will take, and you won't see immediately within 1 or 2 years of construction of this concrete. So don't try to test carbonation in a newly constructed structure. You won't get anything actually, because it takes a lot of time to pass the carbon dioxide front to pass through concrete and reach the level of reinforcement. It is simply tested by using a phenolphthalein solution. 1% phenolphthalein solution, we use it here. 1% in 90% of ethyl alcohol and remaining water, and we mix it and spray on the newly drilled concrete, and we spray it here, and then we measure this depth of the concrete, up to what depth the carbonation has reached here from the surface. This pink coloration will show you no carbonation. Concrete is perfectly all right, and there is no coloration actually, then that part is got carbonated. This again, I told you, this is a bridge pier in Kerala, just on the backwaters. But it is when we tested, it is about 25-30 years old structure. Even then, there is no crack on this pier and no carbonation also, you can see here. You've only damaged by making a small drill here. It's a very good construction they have made, and that time, and even now it is in a very good condition. This is a photograph shown by madam. Actually, you can see here, this part, a small part here, this is, mind you, this also from a Kerala structure, from Hazard, Kerala only. It's a building basically, not a bridge. Building wall we have tested, and a small part, you can see no coloration. This only got carbonated. The rest of it are pink only. There's no carbonation here. You can see the rebar here at about 70 mm depth actually. Very good concrete cover they have given. That's why concrete got protection from the concrete. You can see the rebar. Rebar rips also, you can see here. Very good condition. Nothing has happened to this rebar. This also about 30 years old structure when we tested this structure actually. Also, sometimes what happens, you will wonder, the carbonation, you will see corrosion because of carbonation on the inside structures in houses and all, compared to the concrete gutters at the site. But also the gutter side, which is exposed to the environment of rain and all, they get less corrosion compared to the inside portion of the gutter, which is not exposed to the rain. Because the carbonation front, as I told you, carbonic acid getting deposited on the surface, and with the water, it gets washed away. Right? The ones which are exposed to the rain gets washed away. That's why they will have lesser carbonation depth compared to the one which are sheltered from the rain. These are sheltered from rain. That means they're not exposed to the rain. So they are showing higher carbonation depths compared to the open structures exposed to rain. So this is normally we don't expect, but this is the reason here actually. So that's why I told you the sheltered outdoors will have a higher carbonation depth compared to the ones which are exposed to normal rain and all. Similarly, when you increase the concrete strength, the depth of corrosion carbonation will decrease. We will determine the depth of carbonation from the top surface of the concrete. How much depth the carbonation has taken place. There is no white coloration, pink coloration when you spray the phenolphthalein solution. That part is called carbonated concrete. And also, this carbonation actually is very much dependent upon the relative humidity of the concrete. And in very dry concrete, dry environments, there will be no carbonation. That means in a very dry concrete. Similarly, in a completely immersed structures, also you won't see carbonation, because in a dry concrete, carbon dioxide cannot enter into concrete actually, dry environment. Similarly, in the completely wet environment, it can't dilute, dissolve in water and reach the level of concrete actually. But only at this alternate concrete exposed to relative humidity, 60 to 70% and all, here only you will see this kind of high carbonation rate. So you have to be careful when you are analyzing our structure. So what factors are affecting our rate of corrosion? The quality of the concrete, which is given by your cover. If your concrete cover is very good, then nothing to beat it actually. Good quality and good cover, don't have to bother about it, about our structure. Permeability, low permeability concrete, I told you, they also will have high durability. And cement content, adequate cement content. I won't say very high cement content, and I won't say very less cement content also. It should be properly designed, and that amount of cement you should use. And proper curing you require, and low water cement ratio, of course, is recommended. And this corrosion is, as I told you, environmental factors like moisture, temperature, chloride and carbon dioxide, they affect your reinforcement, they promote corrosion. And construction related, like I told you, concrete cover, compaction, I will not repeat it, but these are all the factors which affect the corrosion of reinforcement. This part is over. Now I am going to sulfate attack. Very quickly, we'll see this. This is one more actually problem in when some of the concrete structures which are in contact with the soil or marine waters actually. Marine, the bridge piers which are in contact with the seawater will have, will attack this sulfate attack, or the piers of a bridge ground containing a lot of sulfates will have this effect also. The sulfate attack actually, there are four types are there. Thermal external sulfate attack from marine water or soils, internal sulfate attack, and delayed ettringate formation, and thermoset attack. I will tell you briefly what are these things and all. Don't bother about so much of chemical equations here. Just see here, normally our seawater will have two types of sulfates. Sodium sulfate, we are very familiar with this, and magnesium sulfate. These two are there, and you remember this calcium hydroxide, again coming from our cement hydration. These two will react once the sulfates enter into concrete. What's happening here? The reaction will give you this gypsum, basically very soft material, no strength at all. So in the concrete, the soft natured gypsum will get formed because of this sulfate reaction with our calcium hydroxide. That leads to loss of strength to the concrete. Remember, this sulfate attack basically attacks concrete, not the reinforcement. There is no corrosion here. Concrete is getting attacked here. Similarly, in carbonation also, first the concrete gets attacked, then reinforcement corrosion will start. Whereas in the case of chloride, there is no problem to concrete. Nothing is happening there. Simply our chlorides are going through concrete and reaching the reinforcement level, attacking the reinforcement. No, nothing will happen during that time to the concrete material. After corrosion starts, because of the expansion forces, the cracks will start actually. They will appear on the surface. This is the difference. The sulfate attack does not cause immediate corrosion. It will only first attack the concrete, and it will reduce its strength of the concrete. That is the difference here. The one more thing is the magnesium sulfate. It's a very, very dangerous material. Whenever it is there, it reacts with the calcium hydroxide, again forms this gypsum and product of magnesium. But the problem here with when magnesium sulfate is there, you remember, just see this equation here. tricalcium silicate hydrate. Remember, it is basically our tobramurate, strength giving material actually of cement hydration. This one, just to remember this. And in the presence of water, what is happening? It is ready converting into gypsum. Magnesium sulfate on reaction with the cement hydration product is simply converting it to gypsum. That means whole strength has lost. This is the strength giving component of the cement concrete, and it has gone to become gypsum only. See, the strength losses, and that leads to deterioration of the concrete. Spalling will take place, and the spalling and they come out, the concrete patches will come out actually. They fall off. And here one more thing, because of this sulfate, just listen here. This is C3A, our cement tricalcium aluminate. This is only, if you assume one here, single sulfate here actually. This is sulfate actually. Monosulfate it is called. It is normally in hydrated cement, it is there. On reaction with the magnesium sulfate, this forms tricalcium silicate. Ettringate it is called basically. This bloody ettringate will form when during just early stages of cement hydration, when concrete is soft. It will have a lot of high volume, but because of the soft of the fresh concrete, nothing is there. But in the hardened concrete, if it forms, this will expand actively, that leads to cracking in the concrete. This ettringate formation during in the hydrated cement concrete will lead to cracks in the concrete. It is called sulfate attack. Particularly the post-tensioned floor slabs, footings, garage floors, foundations, and retaining walls or street curbs, all these get attacked by sulfate attack whenever sulfates are there in the soil. It also gets attacked in the spring water in Elbe River Bridge, Piers in Germany. Many of the dams in many countries got attacked by this sulfate attack. Some examples of this sulfate attack you can see here. In a dam structure, it's got damaged, the concrete got damaged. See here, so because of the sulfate attack, the spalling because of the sulfate attack on a structure. Similarly, this water also containing a lot of sulfates, and this foundation getting damaged here. You see, I showed you already, it's a footing of a residential building getting attacked by sulfates. One more example here. In our IS 456 also, the cement should not contain more than 4% of the sulfate because of this reason. It may lead to sulfate attack. If it's containing higher sulfate, SO3, then that leads to internal sulfate attack. That's what I was referring at that time. If it has got more than that, then it leads to sulfate attack. So we should have a knowledge of our sulfate content of the cement used in the construction. Then it will be helpful for ascertaining the sulfate attack in the concrete. Suppose if you don't know, later you test it in the hardened concrete, the sulfate content can be measured, and if it's found to be more at a later stage than that was present in the cement content, then that shows it's a sulfate attack. That means you know initially what was the sulfate content of your cement, and at a later stage when you test it, if you find more sulfate content, that means that your concrete is getting attacked by sulfates actually. That is the meaning of that. This is a phenomenon normally we come across delayed ettringate formation. We come across in the precast concrete members. If they are subjected to higher than 60 degrees of temperature, what's happening? This kind of sulfate attack will take place. It's basically again ettringate formation. Your C3A is there, sulfate is there. This is basically initially it is forming. This gypsum, we're adding about, you remember, 5% gypsum we add during to our cement during a manufacture. This will react with our tricalcium aluminate to form, this is ettringate actually. But if you are making a very high temperature concrete, suppose during a precasting, this step is bypassed. Directly, you are going to, I'll just go back. You're going to this stage, monosulfate. This stage is getting bypassed, but later stage what happens whenever there is some sulfates are there, this reverse reaction will take place, and this ettringate will form there, and that leads to cracking in the concrete, because it ingot will have a higher volume. It will occupy more volume, and in the hardened concrete, there is no space for that. That leads to cracking. That's called delayed ingot formation. Mostly, you will see it in precast structures subjected to steam curing actually. Otherwise, that's why normally we recommend less than 60 degrees of temperature curing for precast members. This is some of the examples of the delayed ingot formation, a form of sulfate attack. Some more examples actually. This is the last type of attack, sulfate attack. This is a form possible only when four conditions are met. You have got some surface source of sulfate in the soil. Lot of plenty of water is there, moisture is there. Limestone great whenever you are using actually. This is the condition. And also at low temperatures, when these four conditions are met, then there is a sulfate attack that's called thermosite attack. It's basically a form of sulfate, a type of sulfate actually. It's a mineral, lime and sulfate, they will react to form this kind of mineral, and that leads to cracking in the concrete like this actually. You see, this concrete got damaged here on a foundation. This you can see this pavement got damaged very badly because of that attack. But we don't come across that kind of situation. Our limestones are in Rajasthan side, and it never experiences minus 15 degrees of temperature. See, so we don't get this kind of just, but only for your knowledge I'm just sharing. The last one is alkali silica reaction. We think that our aggregates are very good, and there's nothing to look at it actually. But actually, some of these aggregates, of course, that's real. Aggregates are normally neutral. They don't participate in any reaction. They give shape to the concrete, as I told you in the beginning. But some of these aggregates have got, particularly the silica containing aggregates, will have a type of silica strain, what we call, and that is very, very reactive. That normally silica is not reactive. Sand and all, it's not reactive. Sand contains silica only. It's not reactive. But aggregates will have some type of silica which are reactive actually. These are those types of silica which gets reacted in the proper environment. Right? So what's happening here? We have got this aggregate silica will be there, reactive silica will be there, and this alkali is coming from our cement hydration, calcium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide. This will react, it will form a small gel, sodium silicate. It will be there in the concrete, but if it is there, no problem. But if it comes into contact with the water, suppose for any reason, then this gel will expand, right? That leads to what is called alkali silica reaction. That leads to, again, this is again a concrete problem only, not the reinforcement problem. Concrete will get damaged because of this reaction. Whenever you use a type of aggregates contain this kind of silica, and of course, then this problem will take place, and it leads to cracking in the concrete. This kind of cracking, it's called chicken mesh type of cracking, it's called, and you can see here, this type of cracking, the concrete will get damaged, and it gets spoiled off. This is called alkali silica reaction. These are all examples of the alkali silica reaction. So many type of cracks you'll see. He is the man of from USA who actually discovered this phenomena, Thomas Stanton, 1957. First time he brought this kind of phenomena to the notice of engineers, and this is called alkali silica reaction. Right? CG is the great particle, and the cracks actually, because of that, the cracks will develop here all along, and with that, that gel will get into these cracks. And that leads to cracking of the concrete. So I'll skip these things. Now the question is, do we have this kind of aggregates in our India? Of course, plenty are there, but we don't know. You see, so basalt rocks happening in Deccan Plateau, Madhya Pradesh, Hyderabad area, Jammu Kashmir, limestones in Rajasthan area, sandstones again, MP, West Bengal, Bihar. So many are there actually. And do we have an experience of alkali silica reaction? Yes, we have got this Hirakud Dam in Odisha. foundations and some of them got damaged because of the Salako Silica reaction. But the unfortunate thing is this kind of reaction is a slow reaction. You won't get to see in one or two years. It will take a lot of time, 10 years, 15 years. Then only you will get to see this kind of reaction, this problem actually. Similarly, Rihand Dam in UP, very popularly known, and many papers have been published on study of this dam for the alkali silica reaction. What happened in this Rihand Dam? Cracking of concrete took place because of the alkali silica reaction. The machinery got misaligned because of the expansion of the concrete, you know, the gates got jammed. So, and some of the problems also took place. And this is the example of the Hirakud Dam concrete expansion because of the alkali silica reaction. And this is the Rihand Dam example. See the cracks here actually, and because of the alkali silica reaction. In RV also, in one of the dams, this problem was found. Maybe there are many places, but I'm giving just a few examples. The other one is efflorescence. I told you, the calcium hydroxide in the concrete will get leached away in case of high water cement ratio concretes. And when water is in contact with there, it removes that calcium hydroxide. And this comes out of the concrete and reacts with our carbon dioxide in the environment. This is basically the calcium carbonate. You remember the carbonation product I told you, carbon dioxide plus calcium hydroxide, giving you this calcium carbonate. This is what is the calcium carbonate. Does not actually lead to loss of strength, but for looking, it's very bad actually. The white patches and all, it does not look nice for seeing purpose. So this is what is called efflorescence. The other one is alkali carbonate reaction. I'll skip this. I don't, there's not much of incidences in India at least. So basically another kind of aggregate containing dolomite, calcium carbonate containing magnesium carbonate. This mixture actually, that's called dolomite rocks actually. They react with our alkalis and they form this product. Alkali silica and carbonate reaction basically. So that leads to cracking and deterioration of concrete. But the problem here is there are some methods in for alkali silica reaction to arrest the cracking or to repair it. But the bloody thing here, you can't really stop. It's a cyclic reaction. It keeps on going on despite whatever measures you take. This is the calcium magnesium carbonate dolomite. This is alkali aggregate, hydroxide. It's reacting here, and some carbonate is forming here. Forget about these two. And this is again reacting with our calcium hydroxide, which is there in our concrete, and again forming alkali hydroxide. It's going again to back here and reacting with your aggregates. See, it's a cyclic reaction. So you can't really stop the, once it starts, actually. It can't be mitigated. I told you, no? So, like that.
Dr. Rao, may I request you to please wind up in another 2-3 minutes, please?
10 minutes, madam, please.
10 minutes.
Service production model just started. Maximum 10 minutes, maximum. So now we are coming to this important topic of service life production models. Why they are needed actually? We know our lot of structures are getting deteriorated and we are losing the valuable service life actually. So people have made attempts to estimate the service life of the concrete structures by making product some prediction models. You know, this is a kind of photograph was shown by Lakshmi madam also. Here, what is happening here, the chlorides are starting from the concrete surface here, entering into the concrete cover. They travel all the way here. They reach the level of reinforcement here. Once they reach reinforcement and in some required quantity, the depassivation will happen here actually, right? And this is and from here the corrosion will start and it slowly starts propagating, giving cracks and all on the concrete. Now, the common belief is that this part we can control actually. This is depacification initiation. This is called initiation of corrosion. This is the propagation of corrosion, this part actually. Right? This initiation part can be controlled. We can actually monitor or we can control actually. Once the concrete corrosion starts, it's like a cancer. You can't really stop it unless you take some other measures actually. So this part, we got some control on this. So people have tried to attempt model this phenomena to estimate how long it will take for the chlorides to reach this steel bar and start depassivation. Initiation of corrosion will take place. So this the time to crack of the concrete will depend upon the concrete quality, concrete cover, and the severity of the reinforcement. These three are very, very important. Concrete cover, once again, I tell you, is a very, very important factor. You should actually, like Mr. Gairavar showed you in his slides, you must maintain proper good quality, good cover, required cover in the reinforcement, then to protect your steel reinforcement from corrosion. So basically what is happening, this chloride penetration into concrete is by diffusion mechanism. That means concentration difference. There is a high concentration here in the outside and very less concentration here. So this concentration gradient will drive the chlorides from surface to the reinforcement level. That is what called diffusion. And fixed second law of diffusion, normally we use it, and this is that equation, and the solution is given like this. Actually is the solution to the fixed law equation. The important factor here is this is called DA, is called diffusion coefficient of the chlorides through concrete. That means the rate at which they are traveling through they're diffusing through concrete to reach the level of reinforcement. Other things are given here actually. So if you take small samples of concrete powder from the concrete at different depths, you measure the pattern profile will be like this. At the surface, it will be a lot of chlorides will be there, and slowly as you go down, the chloride content will decrease actually, right? This is, you remember, the 0.4% by weight of cement. This is the critical chloride content. You see, to reach here, you require what depth here actually? 40 to 50 mm. This is the minimum you require depending on the exposure of environment and all. So this is what you maintain this cover. So if it is less than this, then there is no corrosion. That is the meaning of here actually. So the diffusion coefficient is a function of many factors, but basically depends upon the concrete material, water cement ratio, cement type, and cement additives. What if you are adding fly ash or slag, you will reduce the permeability of the concrete, and that way the diffusion coefficient will reduce actually. Higher the diffusion coefficient, higher will be the rate of corrosion. That is the basic mechanism. And also, as the cement hydration proceeds, what happens is the progress of chlorides will decrease, because the pores are getting blocked there, and chlorides cannot pass through concrete so easily. So it's a time-dependent factor. As time passes, it will decrease actually, right? And you can see here, higher the diffusion coefficient, it will can reach the level of reinforcement very fast. At a given depth. So our concrete should have always a low diffusion coefficient. This is the low diffusion coefficient, this is a higher diffusion coefficient. You can see here. And in the attempts to predict the service models actually, many models have come up. Madam have discussed some of them, many of them rather. This Life 365 from USA, it's an empirical model. Computational method is the determination of probability of probabilistic. Duracrit model from European Union. ClinConc, chloride in concrete. This is the model basically from Sweden. Hitek model from again Denmark. Clodif from Croatia, and error function complement. It's the oldest method from Italy. Collapardi and other people have developed this model actually. So I will just briefly go through some of them, and I have taken. See, different models will use different kind of parameters, variables to in their models. This Life 365 uses temperature, corrosion inhibitor if it is there or not, type of steel, or threshold level, administration concrete like that. So other models use different variables actually. That's why the models vary in their prediction capacities. This EFRCM model, the first one, this is the equation they use, and these two are very, very important. Surface chloride and DA, difference quotient, these two are important. And in this model, these two are assumed to be constant actually throughout the life of the structure, which is not correct actually. But at that time, they thought like this. And from here, they have taken concrete samples, they fit into this equation, and they tried to estimate the service life of the structure. That is how they have done. This is the concrete cover depth actually, right? The HITEC model, again, this will give you actually the what is called apparent difference quotient at the time of the exposure. It will actually, it wants this model. And but at the time of exposure, this is not possible to determine the diffusion quotient because no ingress profile, concrete profile will be available for a curve fitting actually. So the model needs some experimental data from short-term exposures up to 1 year at a later stage to estimate the values of DA, EX, alpha, S, and P. These are the values here actually, concrete sulfur, surface chloride and initial chloride and other constant actually. You can estimate from this equation. And from here, you will estimate the, you fit into that again fixed equation and get the service life. Dirac-Crick model is basically it's a mixture of empirical as well as the experimental values. These constants are basically correspond to the curing and environmental related constants actually. So these the migration quotient. It's a testing method available in literature. So that's what they use here at 28 days to get this constant diffusion quotient. From here, they estimate the service life. So I will not go into details of this one because of time factor. And this Dirac-Crick model, basically, as I told you, it's a probabilistic model, and it gives you the probabilities of a structure getting corroded in some range of span actually. And this model is adopted by this FIB model code for service life design. It's based on this Dirac-Crick model. So I'm just passing here. This Life 365 is a very, very popular model, and these are the corresponding equations. Equations actually. So here the difference quotient is supposed to depend upon the time and temperature. You see, temperature also has got a factor here. So that way they have developed this model, and they use this 28-day difference quotient also in their model actually. So this leads to different results. The chloride and concrete model, it's developed for submerged conditions actually. It is basically for submerged conditions, and where chloride solution is constantly in contact with the concrete surface. When the model is used for atmospheric zone, you have to make some modifications. So that's what, these are the corresponding equations actually for the Klingkong model. So this is another model, Clodiff model. Here also they take different parameters to estimate the this thing, DA, diffusion of chloride with time, right? So some attempts have been also made to test these models in Croatia. A 25-year-old bridge from here bridge, some sample concrete sample samples were taken, and chloride sample. Chloride was estimated in the samples, and that profile was used to validate some of the three models actually. Life 365, Dirac-Crick, and Clodiff. These were evaluated using this data actually. This is the parameters they have used for Life 365 model to use it. This is the results actually. You can see different combinations of mind you, in this bridge, what they found is it's a some about 60 70 meters high bridge in the exposure to sea. Here they found different kinds of flood profiles from top to bottom, so it's not constant actually. Similarly, the different quotient also was varying from one part to the other part. So even in the same structure, these values are different. So you have to be careful. That's what they did actually. And for different ranges of different quotients, they estimated the service life of the concrete structure. And definitely they found for a splash zone where concrete gets dried up and wetted, the life is very, very low compared to the normal atmospheric exposed part of the bridge actually, right? This is a Durocrit model. What they have used, basically the probabilistic model I told you, know. So a lot of probability parameters, statistical parameters they have used here. And Clodius model.
Please summarize.
Sure, definitely. So the Clodius model has given very high values actually. You see here, and not very realistic. So they found that this life-sensitive model corresponds very well with the real condition of the analyzed structure of the bridge actually. In Australia also, they did some study of 19-year-old field study they have done, and they have evaluated three models. And they found that none of these models actually are exactly close to the reality. The models are underestimate the chloride ingress after short time. And also sometimes the results are similar to field data, but sometimes they are underestimating or overestimating the chloride ingress. So this is what actually they have found. And also there's a large variation in the exposure condition also in the, in the structure. So that's what, and somebody did sensitivity analysis. Suppose if you increase your diffusion quotient by 100%, you are reducing your corrosion initiation time by half. So that's how important your diffusion quotient actually. Similarly, models are there for carbonation. A lot of work done for carbonation also. You can see this time depth of carbonation is equal to root of T actually, time square root of time. So based on this, a lot of models have been developed for based on physical chemical processes. And Durocrit model also has given some equations to estimate the carbonation this thing. Sorry, I'm just rushing actually. So service model prediction models also are available for alkalical reaction reactions and free star reactions. I'm not discussing it here, but they are there, they are known. So in the concluding remarks, what I'm saying is durability of concrete is a paramount parameter. A high durability of concrete is expected to gain long service life from the structures. Corrosion of steel is concrete is the most widely encountered durability problem. It can be said that the majority of structures are vulnerable to reinforcement corrosion, and adequate precautions should be taken. Attempts have been made to estimate service life of reinforced concrete structures by developing models based on this law. More validation or evaluation of these models is necessary for their wider acceptance. Thank you very much. Sorry for crossing my time, but this is the end of my lecture. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Dr.
Naidu.
Thank you, sir. Now I request the panelists to share their views. I would request Mr. KP Abraham to start with.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes,
can you hear me and can you see me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, let me thank CRI for organizing such a wonderful program.
The screen, please.
Which is attended by, I can see, almost more than 400 participants. It is really a great thing. And secondly, my congratulations goes to Dr. Rao. He has given a very, very exhaustive presentation on.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
And durability and service life calculation. But I feel it is slightly lengthy. Probably you can improve it upon a little bit. Not a criticism, as an advice only.
Thank you, sir.
I only want to add one or two points to you,
sir.
So your entire focus is on reducing the permeability of the concrete. Okay. And the focus is on porosity and how to make the concrete compact, how to increase the grains, improve the grain size, how to prevent the deleterious metals going inside. But equally important is the crack development. It is not discussed cracks. It is the inherent cracks of the concrete. It can come through shrinkage, it can through expansion, it can through many reasons. And unfortunately, our code or specification or contract does not give a lot of that much importance to the crack as much as the porosity. And crack is more damaging than the porosity because if you make a ultra-high strength concrete or a high-strength concrete, ultra-high performance concrete, if it cracks, what is the use? All this has come to almost a useless effort. So crack is one aspect you should take into account in the design of the mix as well as in the design service calculations, inherent the cracks of that one. Secondly, the important thing which I feel is the level of maintenance of a structure. The level of maintenance of a structure is also equally important in determining the durability. And the level of some structure, some people take interest, others may not take interest. And we feel that concrete is something which can be constructed and forgot. Nothing else is required. No, material degrades. Every material has got its own decay or delay. It may be delayed, it may be fast. Just I want to bring one example of the maintenance. I mean, it's out of context. It's not a concrete structure, it's a steel structure. Most of you must have heard about the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. It was the longest bridge in the world till a few decades back. Yeah. You know the maintenance, it is one of the gravest, one of the most active environment of the world. That bridge is situated, most corrosive environment of the world. They have got a system of continuously maintaining the structure, continuously maintaining. It's a steel structure. It's a deck is steel, pylon is steel, cable is steel, everything is steel. They have got a system of continuous maintenance of the structure. They have got 38 dedicated painters every day going, inspecting, find out the spots of distress or corrosion, touch it up, treat it, and then go as per the standard price. And that bridge is as good condition. It's almost 90 years. It is as strong or as sound as it was constructed in 1937. That is the level of concern. That is the maintenance. So we feel that even painting a building once in 5 years or 10 years is a wasteful expenditure. That's our attitude. And Samir is here. He can tell a lot of technology has been developed in the coating. We have got elastomeric coating. We have got crystalline technology. We have got diffusion technology. I feel that all the concrete structure, irrespective of what type of structure is done, we should think about a coating. Maybe 10 years or 15 years interval. That will certainly help you in increasing the lifetime or giving a better performance, because durable structure is not only the value for money, but it's also contribute to the sustainability overall interest. Thank you. Thank you very much. Best wishes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Now I request Professor Jay Prakash to kindly supplement on this topic, please. Professor Jay Prakash.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. Again,
I would like to thank the author who has spoken very well on this and enumerated all these things over here. One of the major issues which he has covered was carbonation and corrosion. Probably the two issues can be better if it give continuous maintenance to the structure. That's what only I would like to add. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Amir Sulaikar, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
First of all, I congratulate Dr. Rao for an excellent presentation within the limitations of time. He covered so much. And to begin with what comments made by Abraham, sir, Bernard Shaw said that there are only two things certain in life, death and the taxes. I would add a third one, and the cracks in concrete. however good you cast a concrete, it is impossible to cast a crack-free concrete. Moreover, I am from the admixtures line, so concrete can be bettered by using admixtures, not only for self-consolidating concrete, but also for corrosion inhibitors can be added. But still, in spite of all your excellent quality assurance systems, the most difficult thing is to cast a good cover that you have mentioned. So the cover, if there is a permeable formwork, there are studies which are done. They say the cover is having 0.1%, 0.1 water cement ratio more than the concrete, more than the cover concrete, and 45 kg per cubic meter cement less than the total concrete in the That means the cover, which is supposed to be the most vulnerable part of interaction between the environment, is the worst cast in reality. So the only solution that remains is, like Professor Jayaprakash said, is by anti-carbonation coatings. There cannot be the durability books included. Anti-carbonation coatings are a must. They are also now very nicely specified in IRC SP80. Because the anti-carbonation coatings, they work on the principles of equivalent cover. So this can be calculated, and these calculations also become a part of durability models. So this is one thing. They can be directly coated when the bridge or something is cast, so that initiation of corrosion doesn't take place. And even if corrosion has progressed to the extent or propagated to the extent where tensile stresses in the cover are not at exceeded to break the cover and to delaminate it, you can still maintain that corrosion at status quo at any time after 20 years or 25 years. You can still coat it with anti-carbonation coatings. So there's absolutely no problem. To touch the second part of the service life prediction, I will just like to touch very one or two lines or maybe five lines. The best one is the probabilistic model. Also, as Abraham sir said, we are always talking about service life prediction only as far as material deterioration is concerned. That means we are talking about the exposure conditions, then what is the degree of corrosion, then what is important is the degree of corrosion and the rate of corrosion. We are forgetting the structural angle. That means predicting the cracks which will come due to loads. I think this is also to be attached to the service life predictions. So there are about 25 tests to be done. If your data is more thorough, the answers are more thorough. And in addition to doing these things, you should take a core from the concrete to do a migration test to prove that the theoretical transfer or theoretical migration or the corrosion rate analysis that you have done matches with the practical things. See, fixed law, there is some problem, because fixed law is applicable only to the concretes in a saturated condition. Whereas in real life, different concretes are at different levels of saturation.
Yes.
So that's why the probabilistic methods. And what is the last point on, which is very, very important, I would like to stress. We always talk about residual life. But in fact, when you do this test and use a good model like Stadium or something, which is more advanced with 25 tests compulsory and the core cuttings from three different exposure conditions under the water, stress zone, and the top, and then test it for the migration contact to know the rate of corrosion and the existing corrosion. When we do the analysis, we should predict the service life of the structure with and without repair. This is most important. That platform or some platform, they generate the four different models or five different models of repair. Because depending on your money available or the budget available, different type of repairs will have a different service life. If you just quote a structure, maybe it is 15, 20 years. But if you replace the concrete totally, then it may be 35 years. So I think this should come out of those studies. Thank you very much. And very nicely, it's a very absolutely very good lecture. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I request Dr. Lakshmi to share her views in quickly so that we can take questions later on.
Yes, I agree with Mr. Abraham, sir, and also Mr. Samir Surlekar, who has supplemented whatever Dr. Rao presented more in detail. And also, my point at this juncture is that, like for the bridge design in IRC 112, like the main important aspect they have stressed is about good quality cover. So they have a prescription given regarding the concrete water cement ratio, minimum quantity of cement. Apart from that, there is additional measures like the bars or the like the liner or the cathodic protection and anti-carbonation coatings, they are given. But what is required is when to use, where to use. I think some sort of a matrix has to be prepared, or a table has to be prepared to guide the designers so that suitably they can incorporate the appropriate measure depending upon the exposure condition of the site, which cannot be like generalized. It has to be specific. So that is my suggestion. Probably some more work in that line is required. And also, like, we have to use whatever this service like prediction models available, not like a black box, but understand what has gone into it, what are the data required, whether we have the sufficient, we have sufficient data. Otherwise, probably we may not, we may land up somewhere which may not be appropriate for the structure. So be cautious, but I think we need more work to be done in this direction. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
So can we take a few questions from the audience, attendees also?
Yeah, definitely.
So you can, the participants can raise their hand. We can take a few questions from the attendees.
Okay.
Pradeep ji, can you allow one of them, because I'm not having the... Meanwhile, I'll ask one of few questions from the chat. People have asked mostly related to the remedial things related to the corrosion. So particularly somebody has asked, what is the treatment for ASR?
Okay.
Yeah.
Should I answer?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. See, the for ASR, I told you the culprit is water. You should avoid water to penetrate into concrete, number one. So before that, the best thing is whatever cracks are there, you remove them and put a concrete with SCMs, that admixtures actually. So that you will have a good, less porous concrete, and give a waterproofing coating on the surface so that you will prevent water entering into the concrete. That water, then you stop that reaction basically. That is how people actually approach. But simply filling the those cracks will not help actually. That's a bad kind of repair. You remove the concrete, put a good concrete, and put a waterproofing layer, waterproofing layer. That is the only way to prevent or arrest this type of problem.
I will supplement. Yeah, I will supplement to Dr. Rao. Actually, there is one statement. If you can follow that one. If there is no interaction between water and structure, there will be very good life for the structure. I thank to all. Yeah.
Mr. Inder Pal Singh from the delegate can ask the question now.
Mr. Inder Pal.
Yes. Yes, are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sir, actually, nowadays, at many places, PVC plastic covers are being used in the concrete. So how these are safe for the durability of the concrete?
Plastic cover.
Any comments on
that? Plastic covers are not advisable, sir, because it will actually affect the bond between the concrete and the plastic. So that is going to affect your durability of the concrete. So I recommend cement blocks only, properly made cement mortar blocks, and that is the only thing I recommend. Plastics are not recommended, not good one actually. It will affect the bond basically.
Mr. Basudevnath.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. Please unmute yourself. Yeah.
My question is that you have talked about service life models.
Mm-hmm.
So among the options we are having, which is the best option for India if we consider the Indian conditions?
See, conditions are basically you need to collect the data, proper data, correct data you have to collect. Then you can fit them into either like Samir said, probabilistic model or less sensitive. Less sensitive model is basically more user friendly, you can use it. Whereas in Eurocritical model, which is a probabilistic model, you need more of data actually, correct data. That's what Dr. Pillai also says. If you have got correct data, useful data, then you can use probability durability model. Duracrete model. Otherwise, Lyse HDPE is very easy to use. That can be adopted.
Life 365.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mr. Manish Singh Rotella, please. Mr. Manish Singh Rotella. I think he's left. He's...
Let us go to next.
Yeah.
Dr. Sharifi, Alex Froze.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yeah. Hello, good afternoon.
Yes, I'm Dr. Sharvil. Actually, I'm the...
Yes, sir.
I lost it.
Hello?
Yes.
Oh, mute. Gentleman has been muted.
Yeah.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Now we are able to hear you.
Yeah, yes. Dr. Sharvil, please speak.
Yes. So actually, I have been working on this field for now 3 years now, since I have done my PhD. And I have also handled two projects which recommended in their tender documents that they should have a particular life for their structures. So one was basically a reinforced concrete foundation for an oil tank. And the second one is a bridge. So I would like to make a suggestion to you that, as you rightly pointed out, the diffusion coefficient is affected by temperature. So what we did for these two projects is that they wanted a life of 85 years to be precise. And they recommended that, so for such a long time, global warming effect will be also quite significant. If you see, there will be increase of at least 3 to 4 degrees. And that increase the corrosion initiation by at least 2 to 3 times. So that should also be considered now into the service life models. And and the second thing is key, we should also have a decision support system, which is kind of, which will allow you to choose a particular concrete mix for a given exposure condition. Because frankly speaking, the exposure condition given by IRC 112, they just state that it is moderate, severe or extreme. This doesn't give you any mathematical formula. It is like designing a beam by stating that the span is very long and the load is very heavy. Just that analogy you can use. So there has to be proper quantification of this durability exposure condition, like what exactly is the amount of chlorides which are present in the atmosphere, ambient chlorides, and what is the amount of chlorides present in the seawater. So these two, I think these things have to be incorporated, which are very important and which will take the service life prediction models to the next level. Thank you so much.
In fact, I tell you, in Life 365 model, if you give the region, if that's for better for America, if you give the region, they will tell you the chloride content of that region actually. So it's automatically it is given. So maybe that's why, as you said, that kind of system we should develop here also properly.
Mr. Uttam Sen.
Let us go to the next.
Next will be Shiv Shankar. Mr. Shiv Shankar.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah,
good afternoon. Hello, good afternoon.
Do you hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sir, I am Shiv Shankar, Project Director from Visakhapatnam PIU, National Highway Authority of India.
Okay.
Sir, we are executing some highway projects marine area within 15 kilometers radius.
Mm-hmm.
So as per the ministry guidelines, the reinforcement is to be provided with fusion bonded epoxy coating FBCB.
Mm-hmm.
But we have been suggested by some other agencies that while this treatment, even after giving this FBC treatment, the vulnerability of reinforcement while bending will result in slipping of coating and getting exposure to the more marine environment, which results in more corrosion of the reinforcements. So therefore, they are suggesting for going for bipolar concreting corrosion inhibitor treatment over the entire concrete surface. So what is your comment, sir, whether it is suggested or not?
See, epoxy coating basically is a barrier coating.
Sir.
Yeah, right. So it does not allow the chloride to come into contact with the bar. But when voids are there on the coating, holes are there, or during bending, it's getting broken, then that kind of coating is useless. It won't give you any help actually in preventing the corrosion. there are some methods where you fabricate the rebar cage and then subject it to this epoxy coating. If that can be done properly, then that would be useful. But simply getting the bar from some market and bending it and using it like that, that may not help. That's from my point of view. Otherwise, of course, there are some studies showing the usefulness of bipolar concrete inhibiting agents. That can be done. But you should ensure the proper quantity there also. So people are saying that we don't know whether it is added or not. You ensure the proper quantity has been added, then it will help actually. Otherwise, maybe Surlekar sir also can comment on that. But this is my opinion.
Sir, that is rightly said. Actually, this is the practical problem. That is the matter actually. You cannot bend the bar afterwards. You have to do all detailing first, then you have to ensure for that plastic coating. Then only it will work. Otherwise, it is dangerous. More than without the bar, without the coating itself. Okay, thanks.
Mr. Manish Singh Rotella, are you hearing me? Kirsty Sasingram.
Shri Surlekar sir wanted to add something.
Wanted to add something, yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Hello. Hello.
Hello, madam. Tell me.
Hello.
Yeah, hello. Yeah, we're listening to you. Please tell me.
Sir, I'm very thankful to you for this great event, even in this pandemic period.
Yes, madam.
Sir, the one thing I'm attracting this presentation is even some aggregates also have some sulfuric attack reactions. Like Dr. VVL Rao sir showed some aggregates which are attacked by sulfate. The things all are the lightweight aggregates alone, right, sir?
Madam, can you repeat? I'm not able to understand you properly. Your voice was breaking basically.
So even aggregates itself attacked by sulfates have some sulfate attacks.
Huh?
So some aggregates in presentation, the things all are the lightweight aggregates alone.
No,
I didn't get you. I'm sorry,
madam. It requires a specific design mix. Actually, if there is lightweight aggregate, you require proper mix design.
Yes, sir. Is mixes alone a reduced attack?
Yeah, definitely. Generally, we don't allow this type of sulfate aggregate, but yes, it will, for long life, it will definitely affect.
Thank you, sir.
So Uttam Sen. Mr. Sen, can you hear me? Uttam Sen.
So Lakat, I want to tell something. Just one
minute.
Surlekar sahab kuch comment karna cha rahe the, unko bol lene
dijiye. I want to give some comment.
Hello.
Yeah.
No, I just want to go back two steps back for the bipolar corrosion inhibitors. There are good bipolar corrosion inhibitors and bad bipolar corrosion inhibitors. Nice study has been done by IIT Chennai also.
Yeah.
But let me ask you a simple question. If the concrete is very dense and if you apply anything on the top of it,
yeah.
Now any liquid in vapor form will follow the path of least resistance. What interest that product or that solution has got to go inside and meet the reinforcement, it will first try to evaporate. So yeah, please be careful. These discussions are going on for more than 25 to 30 years when these were introduced. Yeah. But they have got limited uses when concrete is actually not accessible. Well, that is the last option, but that should not be the first option. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Rajamani from SRCO, from Chennai.
Yeah.
Rajamani.
Welcome, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Dr. Rajamani.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, sir.
How are you? Very fine. I just wanted to make 2-3 comments, sir. Say permeability is very, very important, and that can be reduced easily by use of admixtures, mineral admixtures. So you must insist on the mineral admixture uses first.
Sir.
Okay. Mineral admixture creates that pore size distribution differently. One.
Correct.
And any bad concreting is not substitute for all these new things like epoxy coating or coating on the surface of the concrete is not useful. A good concrete itself is assurance for the actually the best protection to the steel.
Durability.
Third point, cover thickness, as you have been telling and everybody knows, is the most important parameter. Many structures on the site are due to lack of cover only. So why not cover thickness measurement a must on the site as part of the, I have never seen any document talking about this. Cover thickness as a measurement should be made part of the records as they do for the compressor strength. This is my
quality assurance also they are making.
They are not measuring. Nobody measures the cover thickness on the site. Show me one place. And most of the places, it is only lack of cover which has created the corrosion and the deterioration in the country. Nowhere else, nothing else.
Thanks,
whenever there is a cover thickness of in SERC, a 3mm cover for a M30 grade built in 1960s, that water tank was okay for even after 35 years. That is the importance of good cover. So
sir,
a cover measurement must be made compulsory.
Measurement
is different issue. That is my very close
observation. Yes, sir. This is a very valid question. And now people are more conscious about the durability. So definitely it will come very soon in the our coastal region also.
I want to add one thing. Hello.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rajamani.
Yeah, please tell me.
Actually, this... I think previous lecture was covered by me. Actually, provision of cover blocks, that is already there in the codes.
Don't tell me all those provisions.
Let me complete.
I'm not interested in
provisions. Sir, let me complete, sir.
Please it.
No, let me complete, sir. Sir, let me.
Part of the record.
No, let me complete it, sir. Okay. The supervision consultants, you can say due diligence in terms of making the records also and measuring at the site. I showed some of the sites also.
What is some?
Let me complete, sir. CSIR, CRI have also been involved in some of the supervision works. I showed one success story. So if due diligence is followed and that is patronized by the owning agency as well as the, you can say, contractor. Contractor is bound to follow if the owner agency is sensible. And not, I mean, sir, if everything is there with due diligence, that can be addressed. But yes,
Lotus Temple
is
the most
yes.
important example of how the control of the cover thickness was measured there and maintained.
Yeah, I mentioned you can say very small structure, Meerut Tiraha grade separator. Not a single you can say complaint about the cover is there. We applied the non-destructive testing technique also, and that structure is very much situated.
Testing is not meant for cover thickness properly.
Sir, let me
do it.
No, physically means we have been involved as a supervision consultant also. Those records.
Not 100% for but it doesn't
matter. No, you please.
Something is there.
No, that is there, sir. That is there. We have to have a faith also.
Yes.
Means people, they are doing due diligence also, and good work should needs to be appreciated also. Okay. However, your point is well taken.
Thank you, Gavaji.
Sorry for I am a little bit, passionate in talking the points. If it hurts somebody, I'm sorry.
It is activated to all the participants. Very good, sir.
Samir talked very correctly. The bipolar corrosion, all these are good, but they are not substitute for bad concrete at all.
Yeah, definitely, sir.
Yeah,
good.
I just want to add here something.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, actually, the concern raised here is we to make cover measurement in pedantry as a part of our quality check, as a matter of policy, basically, and which is not in place. So that is, I think, the concern, because cover is the main reason for ingressing of corrosion. So
that's
the point, basically. If we can have some sort of protocol in our quality testing so that it can be followed universally.
Definitely.
We can have some guidelines on that. That's if we can just add few points depending upon the square foot or square meter of the area of the concrete. That okay, you have to make cover measurement and satisfy the design cover in that particular region. So that would be, I think, the guidelines to comply with. That can be considered if you can talk to IRC or somewhere, because cover is the very serious measurement, and which you cannot, do after concreting or once it's hidden. You know only after when something happens to the structure. So we can really think of, and we can add this as a check while making the other check, like necessary compressive strength or reinforcement tensile strength. So that's my point.
Thank you. Rauji, kindly conclude for today.
Yeah, Dr. Lakshmi, please.
And one more thing, Rauji. One query has been raised by Shiv Shankar. He is our PD at Visakhapatnam.
Yeah.
Actually, that's the query I found from most of the candidates, that about the fusion bonding of the reinforcement. And yeah, this is giving problem everywhere. Because when you go for bar bending or you cut the bar, or that has to be done at the site. Yeah. And that's become the point of,
more dangerous. Yeah,
so definitely. We have to really address this issue. I mean, you cannot have it. I have also seen in many NHA projects where in coastal regions they are constructing and just for the sake of, chemical treatment, they just pour somewhere reinforcement and then start working on it. But exactly that doesn't happen. So this methodology for fusion bonding and the applying epoxy has to be very, very carefully seen again. So, yeah, I mean, we have to really look at it very seriously. I mean, how can we overcome?
That is the practical problem, Goyalji. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, Dr. Lakshmi, please.
Yeah. I thank all the panelists for their expert comments and participants for their keen interest. We have been getting so many questions, and only some of the questions we could answer. But I am sure that we will be answering them either through email, when the questions are available to us, and all the presenters for making excellent presentation. And I hope that this is the first attempt we are doing through this webinar mode, whether you are able to really understand and all, but I'm sure that people are taking keen interest, because still some more than 260 participants are there online. So probably I think we can close the session now, and tomorrow morning, I think 10:30, we will start again. So I request all of you to join us in this platform tomorrow. Thank you very much for your participation. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Navit, you can just narrate the tomorrow's program. What are the lectures topic?
Okay, sure, sir. So tomorrow we have three lectures. The first lecture will be on inspection of bridges and condition rating by Then we have NDT for condition assessment of structures by Mr. Gherwar. Then the third lecture is on load rating of bridges by Dr. Rajiv Goyal and Sri P.P. Gola. So we'll start tomorrow at 10:30 for this session 2 of the three-day international webinar.
Thanks to everyone, and let us enjoy our lunch. Okay, we will we will wait for you tomorrow at 10:30. Definitely. Thanks
to
all of you.
Thank you.
Let us we can close this session.